So good afternoon and welcome to the 5th annual UCSF School of Dentistry Global Oral Health Symposium. My name is Benjamin Chaffee. I am the director of our program in global oral health at the School of Dentistry, and I am delighted to see how many people have come out today to see our lineup and support our program, and I expect we'll see more people filing in as the afternoon moves along. So our program and our event, this is now our 5th year, has truly grown as the years have gone by. Really excited by the support we've seen. I think that speaks to certainly the quality of the lineup. We have some outstanding speakers to present today, and we're very proud to have them with us. I think this reflects a really growing interest in global health as a concept in education, as far as it applies to professional education among dentists. I strongly believe that the ideas of making sustainable impacts, of understanding the social determinants of health, of working in an interdisciplinary nation, in an interdisciplinary way with our colleagues, are all principles that are going to separate our graduates as true professionals as opposed to technicians of the mouth. So our theme today is nutrition, sugar, and oral health worldwide. And it's very tempting to say that this is a timely topic, that it could not be more timely as the effects of sugar and nutrition on our health become so profound. You know, for me, I think it was a real tipping point right around 2011 when journalist Gary Taubes published a New York Times Sunday Magazine piece called "Is Sugar Toxic?" And it seemed like that article was followed by a deluge of publications in the popular and academic press about the negative impacts of sugar on our bodies. And it makes it seem like a modern phenomenon. But yet, UCSF professor Robert Lustig gave an outstanding address at last year's Dental Alumni Association meeting that he subtitled when he spoke about the impact of sugar on our bodies. Well, what did the dentist know, and when did they know it? And it made me think about Willoughby Miller's chemoparesthetic theory for the dental caries process. Miller basically hypothesized that the sugars we consume in our diet are then used by the bacteria in our mouths for energy, and that process of converting sugar to energy as a byproduct results in acids that cause decay of the teeth. We proposed that theory in 1890. Our profession has basically had a modern understanding of sugar and teeth for more than a century. And yet here we are on a very timely topic about its impact on health. So I'd like you all to think about that when we listen to our speakers and the implications for what our profession ought to be doing going forward. We're very grateful today to say that our symposium is co-sponsored by our colleagues at the Philip R. Lee Institute for Health Policy Studies. They reached out to us and they said this topic, sugar, nutrition, interprofessionalism, is so important to us. We want to make that as accessible to as many people as possible. And that co-sponsorship has come true through the videotaping that's going on today. So we're hopeful that the events of today are going to be up on the web and available for people worldwide who are unable to join us here in San Francisco. So a huge thanks to them. This is our 5th annual symposium, and there would not have even been a first if it wasn't for the leadership of Dr. John Greenspan, our first dean for global oral health here at UCSF. It is his vision and forward thinking that brought us all together and made this program possible. You'll hear me thank him many times, but first a thank you and applause to him. And finally, we couldn't be doing this program if it wasn't for the leadership and support of our dean, Dr. John Featherstone, who's been just tremendously supportive. You'll hear him say that global oral health is part of the mission and the strategic plan for our school. We couldn't be more happy about that. It sets the culture all the way from our leadership to our students and everyone working together. So tremendously thankful for him. And in fact, I'm now going to turn over the microphone to Dean Featherstone for a brief greeting.
Thank you, Ben, and I'd like to welcome you all here, welcome the our internal folks, and I look around, I see quite a few people from other parts of the campus here as well, and I see people from all around the world. So this is wonderful. So my name is John Featherstone. I'm the Dean of the School of Dentistry here, and have been now for almost exactly 7 years, believe it or not. So time flies when you're having fun. In the first couple of years of my time in this office, we put together a new strategic plan, and that strategic plan was just a few pages long. The bulk of it was in the first two pages, summarizing our mission, goals, and some strategies. And that plan now has basically come to an end, although it will keep on rolling. And we're in the process of putting together the final stages of a new strategic plan for the next 5 years. And I can say to you very clearly that in our strategic plan just finishing now, we called out global oral health as something that we would have as a strategy and where we would go. We had basically nothing official at that point in time. Now it's part of the fabric. I was saying to people at lunchtime that as the people, as our students, prospective students are coming in for interviews, so many of them are asking a question: what do you do in global oral health? They want to know. They want to come to a school. These are people who want to come to a school which actually participates in global oral health. We have a long way to go, but we've come a long way. So in the new strategic plan, I am certain that global oral health will be woven into each of our five major goals. So we're here for sure, and we want to be a presence, and we want to have this interdisciplinary, and we want to have it sustainable. Global oral health begins here at 513 Parnassus, or whatever exact number we are in this building. And I'm so thrilled that several of our people on campus involved with global health have also embraced the oral health part of it. So again, welcome, and my pleasure now to introduce my colleague and friend, Haile Dabas. And Haile has a long and checkered career, and I'm going to only highlight a couple of parts of it. He was the Dean of the School of Medicine, and then became our Chancellor for a relatively short period of time, but was very, very influential in what we were doing as a campus at that point of time. And then he went on to do an amazing thing, and that is to establish global health as one of the main priorities for UCSF, and indeed for UC as a whole. So without further ado, Dr. Haile Dabas, please come forward.
Good afternoon. It is a privilege to be part of this year's Symposium on Global Oral Health. But let me start by congratulating Dr. Chaffee for putting on this wonderful symposium. And Dean Featherstone, although after what he said, I don't know if I should say this, but Dean Featherstone and Dr. John Greenspan for seeing early on the importance of global oral health and ensuring that UCSF would play a leadership role. Allow me also to pay a special tribute to the School of Dentistry and to John Greenspan again for their unwavering dedication and support that enabled the creation of UCSF Global Health Sciences. When 4 years ago, the Young Consortium of Universities for Global Health, CUGH, decided to develop Global Oral Health Interest Group, it was John Greenspan that took the leadership to organize with lightning speed, I must say, the Global oral health interest group of CUGH by bringing together the deans of the major US dental schools. Now CUGH has a membership of 130 universities and the global oral health interest group is the best organized and has some of the best symposia in the CUGH annual meeting, which itself has grown this last 2 weeks ago in Boston. It was attended by 1,600 people from 50 countries. So, John, congratulations, and also thank you for putting global oral health in the academic global health agenda so prominently. Thank you. Now, communicable diseases are the leading health problem globally, and death attributed to NCDs increased 46% from 1990 to 2010. The world is facing tremendous challenges posed by the rapidly changing burden of chronic diseases. Global oral health is an important and growing component of NCDs. 50% of the world's population, or 4 billion people, suffer from dental caries and periodontitis. Changing diet with ever increasing consumption of acidic soft drinks and free sugars is the setting of poor nutrition is one of the main culprits causing an epidemic of dental caries and enamel erosions in developing countries. The good news is that we know how to prevent it. The bad news is that the implementation of sound global oral health policies is met with huge barriers. The surgery volume of the World Bank book, Disease Control Priorities, third edition, which was just launched 3 weeks ago at the annual meeting of CUGH in Boston, advocates a dual approach to the prevention, a top-down NCD policy change, and pragmatic bottoms-up innovation approach. The 2015 Tokyo Declaration on Dental Care and Oral Health for Healthy Longevity calls upon health policymakers and professionals to significantly reduce the global disease burden, promote greater equity, and integrate oral health promotion into the NCD prevention and control and development agenda. The key role that diet and nutrition plays in global oral disease will be addressed in great detail this afternoon by experts in the field. I just want to congratulate you for taking on this topic of immense global health importance. Thank you.
Live in each season as it passes. Breathe the air, drink the drink, eat the fruit. Thoreau's poetry reminds us that what we eat and what we drink not only feeds our bodies, but also nourishes our souls. Indeed, for centuries, how we have celebrated our religious ceremonies and also how we demonstrate our love and comfort to one another, they all revolve around food and drink. And yet, somewhere along the way, we have become disconnected. Disconnected such that many countries in the world today have now become nations of the overfed yet undernourished. This is why it's my pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Riva Touger-Decker from Rutgers University. Dr. Touger-Decker is a registered dietitian and is internationally recognized for her expertise and leadership in nutrition and oral health, nutrition-focused physical exam of the oral cavity, and advanced practice dietetics education. Her research has explored diet and oral facial pain, nutrition and tooth loss, nutrition and oral and facial cancers, worksite wellness, and nutrition-focused physical exam practices of dietitians. She has authored multiple peer-reviewed publications on nutrition and oral health, and is the co-author of the Oral Health and Nutrition Position Paper for the American Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics. She is on the editorial board of Topics in Clinical Nutrition, as well as the Journal of the American Dental Association, where she represents the Nutrition Research Group of the International Association of Dental Research. Dr. Touger-Decker is a professor and chair of the Department of Nutritional Sciences in the School of Health Related Professions and the director of the Division of Nutrition in the Department of Diagnostic Sciences in the School of Dental Medicine. She has received many awards from the American Dietetic Association, the American Society for Clinical Nutrition, the University of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey, and she is also an elected fellow of the New York Academy of Medicine. Her presentation today is titled Nutrition, Diet, and Oral Diseases. It isn't a one-way street. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Touger-Decker.
Thank you. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here and to be speaking on a podium with distinguished colleagues and to be spending the day, the evening last night and the day with distinguished colleagues. And as the woman who introduced me said, we do it all around food. Last night we had a wonderful dinner at the Slanted Door, where several of the types of patients I'm going to speak of and our colleagues will speak of wouldn't be able to eat. So it's not what you said is so true, but we also have to think about that impact of the synergy between nutrition, diet, and oral health is more than a two-way street. And the first time we wrote the position paper, the first few versions of the position paper on nutrition and oral health called it a bidirectional relationship. In the last iteration, my colleagues and I realized, you know what? It's more than a two-way street. There are so many different directions, and I think, you know, we look at it in those directions. You quoted Thoreau, I go to Hippocrates, which said, let food be thy medicine, except when any of these get in the way. If we think about things like oral toxicities, which first came to light when we look at head and neck cancer, and they are symptoms due to the treatment. So I want you to keep the terms oral toxicities and symptom burden in your head over the next 40 minutes, because it affects more than head and neck cancer. Think of the oral toxicities of some of the dental treatments, systemic health treatments we give our patients. All meant to improve the care, but it's like when we hear the saying, the surgery is a success, but the patient dies. The treatment may be successful in treating the condition, but what are the other impacts of that treatment? Then symptom burden, which is the sum of the severity of the symptoms and the patient's perception of the impact of those symptoms on activities of daily living, on eating. So my objectives this afternoon are to explore the relationships between nutrition status, oral and systemic diseases, with a focus on the work we've done in head and neck cancers, oral facial pain disorders, and tooth loss, as well as our approaches to interprofessional collaboration that we've modeled at Rutgers School of Dental Medicine. And we started it over 20 years ago, before it was called interprofessional. We called it transprofessional. We called it multidisciplinary. Whatever it is, it's when you have two or more professions working together to help our patients. I think the trajectory and degree of relationships varies with the disease, the treatment, and the patient response, that symptom burden. And there's no better example, I think, than head and neck cancers, because the patients are so, they're already ill when they come to us. It's usually lack of swallowing that brings them to the physician or the oral medicine specialist or their dentist. They then go through chemo and radiation therapies and surgeries, and the ensuing anatomic, mucosal, and sensory changes, which impact their ability to eat, but also their desire to eat. In turn, that eventually impacts nutrition status and eventually the treatment response. We often don't think, and we've done some work that shows that treatment response, their response to the treatment, whether it's chemo or radiation or even oral surgery, is dampened if their nutrition status is not up to par. So if you think of how the surgery, the chemo, and the radiation treat the disease, but the residual oral toxicities and symptom burden impact motor function and sensory function, and I try to consider both, let alone the social impact. We often see reduced mandibular opening, therefore biting and chewing force is impacted. Difficulty moving the food around in the mouth, so what we tend to call oral dysphagia, swallowing difficulty. Then on the other side, there's the sensory impact. Whether it's on appetite, because eating's associated with pain, whether it's on taste, food doesn't taste right, food has no taste, food tastes bad, aroma, or the feel of the food. And we often think of that food feel when you're thinking of the patient getting a maxillary full denture, and you have the plastic covering the sensory feeling mucosa. Here, the food feel may be altered because of the radiation therapy, and then the texture. We can see those sorts of oral toxicities in the head and neck cancer patient throughout the recovery process, and as I'll show you in a bit, even after that. That early stage from as soon as treatment completion to 3 to 4 months, the mid stage 4 to about 10 months, and then the later stage, that almost 1 year to 2 years out. And I think you all know, probably better than I do, the dental problems that ensue, the oral problems that ensue, and then the taste changes, which result in the nutrition problems, the diet and the nutrition. So the local impact, my ability to eat, then the nutrition problems that ensue because my consumption has gone down. Quality of life is affected because eating-related quality of life is affected. That whole socialization piece. And we tend to see weight loss and malnutrition and eventually an altered treatment response. So if we think about that symptom burden, we have to consider that these patients need flexible diet and nutrition strategies because their ability to eat is dependent on the oral toxicities, the symptom burden, the adaptive behaviors. We then go further and break those adaptive behaviors, and again, I think you can carry this through to other areas of oral health as well, to the positive adaptive behaviors. I chop up my food. I use rinse and spit agents to allow myself to eat. To the maladaptive behaviors, I'm not eating. I'll avoid foods. And in turn, the impact of that on nutrition status. So, you know, here you may think, all right, it's a one-way street, but it's not because it turns around and affects the oral health integrity as well. So we sought to answer that question, and there was a tool developed by colleagues of ours at Vanderbilt, by Murphy and Cooper Smith and others, that looked at, it's called the Vanderbilt Head and Neck Symptom Survey, and it looks at acute and late effects of concurrent chemo radiation and has patients rank them from 0 to 10. And it's been validated in the head and neck cancer group. And it assesses symptom severity and that patient perception of symptom impact, so symptom burden. Looks at nutrition, looks at swallowing, eating concerns, so what concerns the patient about eating? Not our concerns, but theirs, the consumer. Xerostomia, mucositis, mucosal sensitivity, speech. taste changes dental health. So in this study, we looked at, I don't have a pointer, unfortunately, I'm sorry, symptom burden head and neck cancer patients, and we had 43 adults at three different stages. So we had 15 in the early stage, 7 in that mid stage, and more of them were in the later stage. Primarily male, which is typical of the head and neck cancer group, 97% Caucasian. This was done out in Minnesota at a group of cancer centers. Their mean weight loss from diagnosis to treatment completion was 7.9% of their body weight. So if you think of how long the treatment is, let's say it's somewhere from 0 to 3 months, they've already lost 8% of their body weight by the time treatment's completed. And what we saw was additional weight loss throughout. We didn't start to see any gain until that late stage. So another 3.35% at the early stage, 4.25% at that mid stage. So you finally start to see a 0.5% increase by the time they're almost a year out. Why did we use percents? Is because we have to have some type of normalizing factor, because they come in at different weights. So if we look at percent weight change, that allows us not to look at the pounds, but at the percent of body weight. So they enter the recovery stage already impaired. Then we looked at, all right, what are the VHNSS scores over time that remain problematic over those three stages? And if you look, the problems with dry mouth are fairly consistent independent of the stage. The problems with dry mouth that make chewing and swallowing difficult, so not just the problem, but that makes it difficult, continues. And taste is altered. So all of these are impacting their eating ability. And as you can see, there's nothing, even at the late stage, that has a severity rating of under 4. So even almost 2 years out, we think it's success. The patient has survived, they're back in their activities, some activities of daily living. But their ability to eat is significantly impaired. So then we took, and I apologize for the slide, but I'll walk you through the key points. This was published in Support of Care in Cancer. We looked at symptom burden scores, oral energy intake, so calorie intake, and protein intake. And we looked at correlations with and without controlling for weight change. So you can see mucosal sensitivity without controlling for weight change has a moderate correlation, that the greater the weight, negative weight change, the lower the energy intake. Once we controlled for weight, it was no longer significant. That was in the early stage. In the mid-recovery stage, where we saw the issue was with dry mouth, independent of whether or not we looked controlled for weight change, dry mouth and protein intake and calorie intake had very high, very strong correlations. So the more the problems with the dry mouth, the lower the energy intake, the lower the protein intake. Same thing with mucosal sensitivity during that mid stage, so that 4 to 10 month treatment stage is really a major problem, because they're continuing to drop weight, and this is when you're trying to get them to recover and regain something, and they're still losing, and these are the reasons why. During the late stage, there was no longer any significant relationships, but as you saw in the earlier slide, the problems ensued. So what did we conclude? And I'm sure you can guess this as well, that we need to recognize and assess the impact of the specific symptom burdens on the patient's diet, on what they are eating and why, on their weight, on their nutrition status, and on their quality of life, because food is socialization. And distinguish between the maladaptive and adaptive behaviors. That would mean we'd have to talk to the patients and really look at this qualitatively. And diets need to be designed to manage the burden, minimize the weight loss, and maximize quality of life, yes, restoring their health. But we can't do that unless we can figure out what are the maladaptive and adaptive behaviors. So it led us to the question of what happens in the long term. What happens to these people over time? So that meant us doing a mixed method study. And we continued this much because my graduate student moved. And we did it with a group at Vanderbilt University, where we went until we had saturation of variables. So we ended up with an N of 10, mean age of 55, primarily male again, an educated and working group, because these were long-term survivors that were 3 to 11 years post-treatment. The majority of them had resumed social alcohol consumption, and they had all had concurrent chemo radiation. Some had also had induction chemo, and half of them had had surgery. We went with the following theoretical model, which was based on some of the issues we've seen in patients who are survivors of bowel disease who are long-term dependent on TPN, total parenteral nutrition, thinking, was there a relationship there? So we looked at how is adaptation affected by physical and functional loss, psychological support, so what support did they have, underreporting, senses of loss, yearning, regret, coping, body image, self-image and identity, and we heard a lot of that this morning in discussion with some of our other colleagues, and current health, and then said, what's the impact of all these things on symptom burden, eating, and how do survivors adapt? So what did we find? What you can see here is the gray bar is the data from late stage in the prior study. Yes, a different sample, but we thought it was important to show the two. The red bar is what we still saw. So if you notice that there is still nothing that has a VHNSS score in these 10 people below about 2.5. So you have long-term ensuing problems with taste, dry mouth, and duration of eating is the longest, is one of the bigger problems that's consistent, and how the lining of their mouth is sensitive. So the two biggest things were these two factors. So what were our conclusions? Because the qualitative interviews of these patients did not at all match the VHNSS scores, because they learned how to adapt. They took survival and took it from that perspective. Those who were the furthest year out, so the subjects that were 9, 10, 11 years out, really saw no problem. So it takes me 2 hours to eat. I don't care. So I go out and I play with food. I don't care. It was a very interesting dichotomy. So the patients worked with my student researcher to come up with this adaptation model. And the thematic categories that we had were the functional impact, the social impact, the psychological impact, and then the quality of life and the quality of life with the eating experience. The themes we saw were fluids with meals were a given, and they figured out what fluids they needed. They dealt with mucosal sensitivity by changing their diet. They dealt with limited food taste by highlighting the senses they could taste. They dealt with compromised dentition by cutting and chopping their food. They adapted food preparation, or they adapted the restaurants they went to. One subject was, I remember reading this, it was so poignant. She didn't go out to eat, and it was a celebration of her best friend's birthday because they were going to a Mexican restaurant and there was nothing she could have there. And she said that was the turning point in her life where she realized she had to take the initiative, she had to be the suggester to figure out how to reintegrate herself into society when it comes to eating. The social impact was learning how to make food choices, learning how to select items on a menu, how to eat in front of others and in public. This morning in our group, in our smaller group, we were talking all about malocclusion issues that some people are seeing around the world. And I would chance to say that some of these social themes probably apply in those groups as well, because people choose not to eat because they can't eat in front of others the way people think of it as normal. The psychological theme that was most striking was their downplaying. They're adjusting to the current situation. They downplay the symptoms because they're alive. And this, whether their methods of coping and support and resilience, that they're a survivor, they could get through this, they can learn how to adapt. They looked at enjoyment of eating and how when it's easier and harder over time. It was very enlightening to us to see this. So we're continuing to look at this. Our next level of research in this is we're just writing the protocol to start to look at the piece of how do we assess the maladaptive and adaptive behaviors, and what do we do with that information? Because that's what's needed to evoke change. So I'd like to switch the picture now to our work in orofacial and oral pain. And I've been fortunate to do work with our group in New Jersey, but also to do some work on an international level with folks at Hadassah Hospital. And as timing would have it, one of my colleagues from Hadassah has now moved to Rutgers, so we're continuing to do some of our work, particularly in the oral facial pain area. So we've looked at muscle and joint pain as well as neuropathic pain. We've looked at myofascial pain, pain related to TMD, whether it's articular or joint pain or the mixed joint and muscle. And what's the impact of that functional challenge in terms of limited mandibular movement that's aggravated by the function of eating? Talking as well, but as a nutritionist, I'm focusing more on the eating piece. We've also done some pilot work, which our colleague in Hadassah is now starting to look at how we're going to expand it, looking at oral lesions. We are, in fact, the eating process, the lesions are aggravated by the sensation of the food. So when you think about it, what's the impact of that movement on the disability of oral function, whether it's eating, drinking, or talking? It prompts the question of symptom burden once again and adaptive and maladaptive behaviors. So here we think, wow, we've always thought all these factors impact on diet and nutrition. But what if there's more than a one-way street in each of those relationships? Those medications impact diet and nutrition, but in turn, they may impact the medications as well. Unfortunately, many of the medications used in oral facial pain can have a side effect of dry mouth, which again impacts food choices. And unfortunately, often those patients turn to sugar intake, which our colleagues will be talking about later. The mood disorders and depression and fatigue that may or may not exist before or independent of the oral facial pain as well impact it. Limited mandibular opening with or without pain, and then the pain associated with oral function. So we always have to keep in mind that the mouth is, yes, it's the first 6 inches or so of the GI tract, but it's the gateway to our nutrient intake. So we did a pilot study where we looked at weight, self-reported height, weight 6 months ago, and then visual analog scale scores for pain on biting, pain on chewing, and mandibular opening. And we had two groups of patients that were coming into our oral facial pain clinic. We had those who had musculoskeletal pain. There were about 54 in that group, so they were the majority of our patients. And these were patients with either myofascial pain or painful TMD, and then those with neuropathic pain. What was interesting was that we're finding that it's the painful TMD myofascial group that has the consistently higher VAS scores for general pain, biting, chewing, and mouth opening. Whereas you see that the neuropathic group has a fairly high VAS at 3.76 for general pain, but the rest of them are all below 3. So they're not having trouble eating. But what we did find, interestingly, is that group had a higher mean BMI. They were much more likely to be overweight or obese than the TMD group. And now we've just written the protocol where we have one of our international students getting ready to look at more closely a mixed method study to say what's causing that problem, why is that relationship there. We see in the musculoskeletal group the higher visual analog scales. So is that causing them to avoid food and they're thinner? Is that the reason? Or is the neuropathic group, is it due to some of the medications they're on, and are the use of some of the medications used with neuropathic pain, some of our antipsychotics, anti-anxiety, are those causing them to be heavier because they're associated with increased appetite? So we're going to try to explore that a little bit more. So that then led to a just fortunate experience doing some work looking at oral pain, so oral lesion pain and dietary intake and composition with a group in Hadassah. And I was fortunate to work with Rakefet Cernitsky and Rafi Benoliel and some others there on a project where we had mostly patients with oral lichen planus, erosive lichen planus, pemphigus vulgaris, and mucous membrane pemphigoid. And we divided them into a study group, so those that had a VAS, a pain score of 1 or less, and then, a control group or a non-study group, which had the VAS score of 1 or less, and then the study group, which were the higher VAS scores. Now, this was done in Israel, where at Hadassah, where most of our population were all Middle Easterners, they were all Israeli or Palestinian. But what you see is the impact of the pain on their cultural diet. The study group was much more likely to avoid harder foods, like some of your breads. Citrus and tomatoes, which are a mainstay of the Middle Eastern diet. Sour foods, culturally very common in their spices and flavorings, and spicy foods, as well as a higher temperature. And of course, alcohol. So we're now looking again to get another study started to say, okay, how do we change the adaptive behaviors? Can we teach them a way to enjoy some of their cultural foods? Okay, somebody serious talking to them. Maybe they can help answer the unanswered questions. Thank you. Whoever you are, you were really the right segue for me. And I couldn't have planned that. We have a lot of questions. And part of it is, the more you look at this research, and you probably know as well as I do, that there's so much heterogeneity in how we do our research that it's really hard to compare some of the studies. So we're trying to determine what outcome markers to use to look at diet. Is it nutrient intake? Is it food group intake? It's really a tough question to answer, and a lot of it depends on what do you want to know, and therefore which tool to use, and is there a validated tool? What are we looking at for nutrition? Because diet and nutrition are two different things. Diet are the foods we eat, whereas nutrition is the assimilation of those processes of digesting the food. So how do we explore nutrition? In children, we often look at markers of growth status and anthropometrics. In the oral facial pain patient, which is more likely an adult, how do we look at nutrition status? And then for oral facial pain. And then what are the impact of the disorders, either by type or by stage of diagnosis and treatment, on nutrition and on diet? And then, again, the flip side of the coin. what's the impact of those factors on the condition. If you can give me better eating-related quality of life, would I have less pain? You know, am I less focusing on that pain? The whole concept of socialization and normalization, if I can eat with my friends, am I less likely to think about the pain, therefore have a lower pain? It's a very interesting dynamic, and that's why we've been caught up in some of this and are just making some of those decisions to say this is the direction we have to go in. So it's one of the areas where there's very little research. So now let's look at tooth loss and what happens when we look at a different type of functional change in diet and nutrition. As you can see, much of the work that I've done has looked at the non-caries piece, and that's by nature of my own background and the expertise I've had available to me to collaborate with, both in students and in colleagues at our dental school. And in the areas I've looked at, which are really that whole systemic nature, that long-term impact. So we know that globally, by 2050, those of over 60 are going to be about 22% of the population. I read a statistic the other day that in New York City, where I live, by 2040, there will be more than 2 billion elderly. And then I realized I'd be one of them. But they're doing all these new discounts to attract the elderly in New York City, so that's a good thing. But the other scary fact is that 30% of people aged 65 to 74 have no natural teeth. And Medicare and Medicaid are not very good when it comes to providing implants, let alone dentures. And the mouth really, again, as I said, is that gateway. We need our front teeth to bite with and our posterior teeth to chew with. This became very visible to me is to the fact that it's not just replacing them to dentures. Early on in my career, I was an internship director at the Bronx VA. And there, every veteran could come in, and they could get dentures if they didn't have them. And if they didn't want them, they still got dentures, because that's what they do. You know, you're entitled to this, and you're going to get treated. I mean, if they really didn't want them, they didn't get them. But, and it struck me as to, why are we forcing them to get it? And what if they don't want it? And why were dentures always coming down to the kitchen on their meal tray? It totally baffled me until I went to work in a dental school and realized patients telling you they take their dentures out to eat with. So it's always been an interest of mine to look at, because it's a major factor. We don't think about how are they eating with it. And one of my favorite stories is a patient in our dental school, and we have nutrition faculty working with the dental students in the clinic. And I was working with a student, counseling the patient on diet for their dentures, and the student's doing the diet interview. And I said, let's ask the patient one more thing. I said, how does it feel to eat? Do you eat with your dentures? No. And at that point, the student said, you never told me that. And the patient's response was, you didn't ask. And it was a very poignant one, because we have to think about that masticatory ability is influenced by how many teeth they have, where they are, their occlusion, and then denture fit and retention. And to have a patient say, no, I don't go out to eat because my denture makes noise and it's embarrassing. So that prompted our question. And this study we just finished several months ago to say, there's a lot of independent studies, but let's look at a systematic review and see if we can do it to say what associations exist between tooth loss and or replacement and malnutrition risk and weight status. So we looked at studies done in westernized countries, community dwelling older adults. We looked at tooth loss or replacement, but the challenge you have, and you probably all know this, is that when you look at the studies, some look at number of missing teeth, some look at the pattern of occlusion, some look at type of tooth replacement. And so we looked at malnutrition risk and weight status. Our exposure variables, or our measures, were full dentition, partial edentulism, complete edentulism, whether they had or were getting an RPD or a complete denture, an RPD combined with a complete denture, an RPD alone, or implant-supported dentures. For our indices of nutrition, we looked at the mini nutrition risk assessment, or the MNA, because that's been validated globally in non-RD populations, so for others evaluating nutrition risk when it's not a nutritionist, and BMI because of the curve that exists between BMI and mortality, thinking those were two good measures, one of risk of malnutrition, one of a gross measure of nutrition status, and chronic disease risk. So we use standard methodology for data extraction. We use the Cochrane risk of bias tool and the modified Newcastle-Ottawa tool. We looked at generalizability, and that's where one of our biggest problems came in, and then data synthesis and analysis. And we went through so many narrative and summary tables because we had at least two people reading or reviewing any article. And when there was any disagreement, there was a third or a fourth person, and a discussion came in. So what did we find? We found that fewer teeth and poorer occlusion were associated with higher malnutrition risk. But it's very hard to generalize that statement because of the various ways that people looked at tooth loss and occlusion. We found that complete denture wearers had higher MNA scores, so were better nourished than those who were edentulous, but they had lower MNA scores than those who were dentate. And those that were partially edentate, as soon as they got an RPD, their MNA scores improved. Then when we looked at occlusal status and BMI, so switching to the BMI measure, those that had fewer posterior occluding pairs, because those were what the BMI studies used, were more likely to be underweight or obese, so a non-normal weight, so to speak, although I hate the term normal, but either underweight or obese than those with more posterior occluding pairs. And from a diet perspective, here's where the interesting thing is. The less variety fruits and vegetables you expect, but more sugar-rich foods. Those with more missing teeth, again, were more likely to be underweight or obese than those missing less. And those with complete edentulism had a higher odds of obesity than any of the other groups. And again, those with only 1 to 7 teeth were the thinnest, so had the lowest BMIs, compared to the edentulous or those with more teeth. When we looked at it with dentures, there was no significant difference among all the denture groups. But as we know that research has shown, the implant-supported denture was associated with better chewing, healthier diet quality. And I think that's a really important point because very often these patients' diets have changed over time, so simply giving them new teeth doesn't change their eating. And better body composition than complete denture, and clearly better chewing ability. So what did we conclude? Well, I'll make the key point, I think, is actually one of the last ones, that we could not do a meta-analysis, and it limited the strength of the research because of the heterogeneity of the data. Those with fewer teeth and poorer occlusion were at a greater risk of malnutrition and more likely to be underweight or obese than those who had all their teeth. Again, there's no causality. We can only look at the associations that we saw. There's limited results that show that implant-supported dentures achieve better chewing ability, healthier diet, and weight status. And we need more of those studies. But those are the expensive studies to do, and it's hard to get any coverage for the implant-supported denture research when it comes to diet and nutrition. Bottom line of all of this, though, leads us into that concept of interprofessional collaboration. None of this work that we've done could have been done alone by any one discipline well, because you need that in-depth knowledge of a variety of disciplines. And that became clear to me many years ago when I did my doctoral work after becoming a dietitian and looked at nutrition and dental education. and then was fortunate to come to Rutgers Dental School to set up a nutrition program and say, I can't just come in and do nutrition. I can only do it if we do it together. Because we have to look at how do we as independent disciplines screen and refer, but also work together. So WHO, since that time, has defined interprofessional work as when students from two or more disciplines learn about, from, and with each other. And I should have said professions, because they differentiate between professions being nutrition, dentistry, whatever, and disciplines being groups within a profession. The key elements include experiential learning, maintaining professional identities. So I'm not doing your work and you're not doing mine. We're doing our own things, but we're doing it together. Purposeful integration and collaboration among disciplines and professions as part of a team. And the goal is all towards improving that health. So as working together as dietitians and oral healthcare professionals, we can really care for that patient. And I think all of the global health problems that we've heard so far and we'll hear more of today really hinge on that fact that we need to have comprehensive care. And if we're doing this research work or service work or training work in other countries, we have to do it together. And to that, and had I known a little bit more about this morning before today, I probably would have thrown in some of the slides on the work I do within my nutrition world, which is training dietitians in some other countries and in our own on how to do nutrition-focused physical exam of the oral cavity. Because if we as the dietitians don't look in the mouth and see, oh, no teeth, or no, mucositis, we can't just go by reading a note. We have to look at that patient completely and say, how do we adapt their diet? In the same frame, I teach the dental students nutrition and say, would you tell your grandmother to eat baby food? Your grandmother would tell you to go somewhere else. Say, you have to teach them to use their knife and fork as their teeth. So it's really training both disciplines how to do some level of screening and referral back and forth. What we've done, and I've had the pleasure of collaborating with some of our other institutions that are here today and bringing it into their schools, is we've created that synergy between nutrition and oral health and interprofessional collaboration. Our dietetic interns rotate with dental students in the clinic and work together for patient care and often for each other, because the dietetic interns may help the dental students lose that year one, year two weight. Dental students may help the interns with their things, but they also work together with the patients. Faculty teach across the two schools. We have a very strong nutrition component in our dental school. Same, we give lectures to our dietetic interns, our undergraduate students, and our graduate students. We collaborate in research, as I've shared, and there's even collaboration in our community service work, whether it's in our country or whether it's working abroad. So what's our model? And I'll sum up with looking at the models we use and the models used historically, promoted now by WHO and others. We look at a health and nutrition risk assessment by the dental student, and we've been doing this now in a few iterations for 20-odd years. And when we first started it, my chair at the time over there, Rich Vogel, who's now at NYU, said, Riva, if we're going to do that, it has to be done in less than 8 minutes a patient. Because if a student is seen at best two patients in the morning, two in the afternoon, they have to lose less than half an hour. So I said, well, it's 6 to 8 minutes. That's 24 to 32 minutes in total. We compromised on that. So in all seriousness, we've limited it to components they're already looking at and a few others. They look at oral status. They do a quick diet screen, particularly in that screening stage, as sugar frequency and eating frequency. They look at weight and height, measure BMI. And they look at systemic and socioeconomic health. What do I mean by that is a simple question that asks, do you ever run out of money for food during the month? Because what we see, at least in the US, is that that last week of the month, food banks and food pantries and feeding kitchens grow in size because people don't have any money left. And if you have a high food stamp population, they're not coming to appointments the first week of the month because they get their check and they're enjoying their food. Patients are then triaged. Are they going to get referred outside of the clinic to a dietitian for systemic and oral health related nutrition counseling? Because our nutrition faculty in the clinic don't do counseling for a patient with newly diagnosed diabetes. We're working within the clinic, within the students, and their parameters. Or are they going to counsel that patient as part of their treatment plan on nutrition and oral health? If they get referred to a dietitian, she or he is going to do an assessment and provide medical nutrition therapy. For example, the patient with newly diagnosed diabetes, obesity. If the dental student is doing it, they're going to do a diet counseling relative to disease or their treatment plan or function, caries, dentures. And our model is very similar, and that's the model we've been doing for years, to what WHO's framework is for interprofessional education and practice. It's really looking at interprofessional education so that we have collaborative practice, so that we can optimize our health care and eventually optimize our population and hopefully have improved health outcomes. And with that, I'll conclude. Thank you.
So we've heard a lot about your educational program and trying to get dentists in training to be able to collaborate and in a two-way street relationship with dietetics and training. How about the dentists who are currently in practice, who may feel very confident in their ability to deliver a removable prosthesis, but not very confident in their ability to assess a patient's nutritional status? What steps could those dentists in practice take to be better assessors of a patient's nutrition status or find the right referral? Where should they be starting?
Good point. In one of the areas, and we've worked with a couple of folks in different areas, we have a project starting now with pediatrics where we had a small grant to develop some education tools, YouTube videos that are going up on websites and whatnot. But within the adult practice community, it can be for referrals, it can be looking to your local dietetic association and just Googling them and contacting them. The Academy of Nutrition Dietetics has a Find a Dietitian resource on their website. And in gaining their own skill, and I think that's where we have some of the biggest problems, not just with dentists, but with dietitians as well, is dare I learn, I have to keep learning. And we see that in the dietetics community and trying to teach them how to do oral screening. Same thing in the dental community, to think, I don't have time. And the I don't have time is the common denominator across both. Within the dental community, I think it's training the triaging that care within the dental office, whether it's the hygienist. Very often, even the dental assistant can be sent for training on how to do this and look at opportunities.
Well, thank you. And
thank you
very much.
Thank you very much.
So right now, one thing we've always liked to incorporate into our annual symposium is to reach out and bring in our colleagues from organized dentistry. We think it's very important. This is not just an academic exercise, but this allows us to connect to dentists in practice and the rest of our profession. And we're very honored to have the president-elect of the American Dental Association, Dr. Carol Summerhays, come join us. She's been a huge friend of our School of Dentistry at UCSF, and we're honored to have her.
Good afternoon. It's always a pleasure to be back at UCSF. The top-ranking dental school in research funding from the National Institute of Health for over 20 years and a global leader in oral health. I want to thank Dr. Chaffee and Dr. Featherstone and Dr. Greenspan for the opportunity to make a few comments about the American Dental Association's role in national and global oral health. But before beginning, I'd like to acknowledge Dr. John Greenspan, who was the recipient of the 2012 ADA Gold Medal for Excellence in Dental Research. This award is made every 3 years to honor individuals who contribute to the advancement of the profession of dentistry and for making major improvements in the oral health of the public through basic and clinical research. Congratulations, Dr. Greenspan. The theme of sugar, nutrition, and oral health is very timely with the release of the World Health Organization 2015 guideline, Sugars Intake for Adults and Children. And currently, we are under review of the 2015 Dietary Guidelines for Americans, to which the ADA has submitted comments to the Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee. On the global stage, the ADA works through the FDI, World Dental Federation. The FDI is comprised of 200 national member associations and specialist groups from over 130 countries, representing 1 million dentists. The mission is to promote the optimal oral and general health for all peoples. Since its inception in 1900, the ADA has contributed organizational leadership and expertise, particularly in the areas of science and public health. Dr. Michael Glick, Dean at SUNY Buffalo and editor of the Journal of the American Dental Association, led the efforts for FDI's Vision 2020. Its aim is to generate discussion and collaboration among the FDI and its partners to shape the future of oral health. I must also mention that the ADA is fortunate to have Dr. Touger-Decker as JADA's, on JADA's editorial board, so thank you for adding your expertise. Now, in the audience, I'd like to introduce Dr. Dan Meyer. Dan, would you stand up? Dan is the ADA's chief science officer, and he's been with the ADA for over 19 years. Dr. Meyer is an expert consultant representing the ADA and outside organizations, including global initiatives at the FDI, the WHO, and the IADR. Now, during the negotiations of the United Nations Environmental Protection Treaty, Dan worked very closely with the FDI and IADR to save the use of amalgam as a restorative material. In the final UNEP treaty, there is a statement that supports strengthening disease prevention and health promotion as the most relevant approach to reducing the need for restorative care. So thank you for that, Dan. Now, many of the ADA's agencies are involved in sugar, nutrition, and oral health. The Council on Science has a caries management subcommittee, and they're developing plans for a national call to action to promote a caries management approach focused on disease prevention by reducing caries risk factors. We also in the audience have the chair of the Council on Access and Prevention. So Dr. Jane Gillette, would you stand? So thank you for being here. The Council has just recently forwarded a resolution to support the WHO guidelines on sugar intake and has encouraged the development and implementation of a comprehensive plan to promote nutritional screening and counseling as a part of routine dental care. So thank you. And through the Council on Dental Benefits, we support efforts to require third-party payers to recognize nutrition counseling in the dental office as an eligible plan benefit. Very important for our dentist. The ADA also offers educational modules to help dentists counsel patients about the importance of maintaining good oral health. And in addition to producing patient brochures on healthy dietary habits, we maintain a consumer website, mouthhealthy.org, as a resource for the public. And recently, we established an interagency sugar and caries work group to develop a policy statement to reduce sugar consumption as a means of reducing caries risk. Now, much of our work involves advocacy at the federal level. Our Council on Government Affairs and our Washington, D.C. office have been instructed to advocate for increased research funding regarding the role that sugar plays in the development of caries for both the National Institute of Dental and Craniofacial Research and the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. Just last week, on April 29th, ADA President Maxine Feinberg testified before the House Appropriations Subcommittee on Labor, Health, and Human Services and Education. We requested $425 million for NIDCR research for fiscal year 2016 and urged the NIDCR to use a portion of its resources to conduct more research on the effects of added sugars and artificial sweeteners on oral health. This request is an increase of over $8 million over the 2015 budget. And in the past 10 years, NIDCR appropriations have been reduced by 25% in inflation-adjusted dollars. The ADA has been a strong advocate for including oral health education in team nutrition, SNAP Ed, WIC, and other food assistance programs. We have pushed the USDA to adopt nutrition standards that promote optimal oral health for all foods offered in schools and to also include oral health education in local school wellness programs. We support the FDA's proposal to require a separate line for added sugars on nutrition and supplemental fact labels to help consumers monitor their added sugar intake. In her testimony, Dr. Feinberg urged other federal research agencies to carve out a role for oral health when conducting any nutritionally related research. Any strategy to improve the dietary habits of Americans can and must include an oral health component. So we all have a role to play: students, faculty, academic institutions, organized dentistry, and other national health organizations. Strong collaboration among the stakeholders is key to our mutual success. So thank you for your time to give you a few of our efforts at the American Dental Association on behalf of oral health.
Well, good afternoon. Many of us in this room have spent their whole professional career trying to alter the epidemic of dental caries, either through community efforts or individual efforts, using strategies based on the intake of fluorides, oral hygiene instruction, or the form and frequency of sugar. Attacking the form and frequency of sugar has been very frustrating, and Cristin Kearns, who will be presenting next, has rolled back the covers to let us know what barriers that we fought against for all these 40 years trying to address this effort. So Cristin Kearns is a postdoctoral scholar at the University of California, San Francisco, with a joint appointment in the Phil Lee Institute for Health Policy Studies in the School of Medicine and the Department of Oral and Craniofacial Sciences at the School of Dentistry. Additionally, she's an acting instructor at the University of Washington School of Dentistry. Her degrees include a BA in neuroscience from Trinity College, a DDS from the University of North Carolina School of Dentistry, and an MBA in health administration from the University of Colorado in Denver. Dr. Kearns first became interested in sugar policy and her role as operation manager for the Kaiser Permanente Dental Care Program in 2007. While attending the annual Institute for the Oral Health Conference focusing on periodontal disease and diabetes, she received instructions on what to discuss with patients with diabetes from the program director of the National Diabetes Education Program at the Centers for Disease Control. Under healthy food choices, limitations were recommended for saturated fats and salt, but there was no mention of limitations for sugar intake. After challenging the second keynote speaker, who promoted the same thing, she was told there is no evidence linking sugar to chronic disease. After years of counseling dental patients to reduce their intake of sugars to help manage oral disease, especially as the dental director of a low-income clinic, the lack of advice on sugars to diabetics seemed conspicuous. Did the science support the mission, or were there other forces at play? Drawing from her scientific background and learning from pioneers challenging the conventional wisdom, Dr. Kearns began focusing on trade associations that promoted the consumption of sugars to look for answers. Kearns discovered the papers in a collection that was left to the University of Illinois Library by the late Roger Adams, a professor emeritus of organic chemistry who served on the Sugar Research Foundation and the Scientific Advisory Board of the International Sugar Research Foundations, which became the World Sugar Research Organization. By herself, in the University of Illinois Library, she copied at her own expense over 1,500 pages of correspondence among sugar industry executives, meeting minutes and other relevant reports from between 1959 and 1971. As a postdoctoral scholar at the University of California, San Francisco, along with her mentors and co-authors, Stan Glantz and Laurel Schmidt, she has used the UCSF platform that was successful in the tobacco wars to unmask the sugar industry's influence on the government and the disregard of the health of the American people and the world. So, Cristin Kearns.
Thank you, Steve, for that nice introduction. And thank you to Ben Chaffee, John Greenspan, Dean Featherstone, and the rest of the organizing committee for inviting me to speak here today. I'm thrilled to be able to participate and share my work with you. Steve actually gave a little bit of my presentation for me here, but I'll expand a little bit on it. As going back to 2007, where I was attending a dental conference in a role as operations manager for the dental program at Kaiser Permanente in Oregon and Washington. And I was really excited about medical dental integration possibilities. We had physicians and dentists under the same roof, and we actually had access to their medical electronic health record. So as dentists in that program, we were looking for ways that we could help manage diabetic patients. And I went to a conference put on by Washington Dental Services. George Taylor was speaking at that conference, as a matter of fact, and learned some interesting things. So I went home with a packet of these pamphlets, Working Together to Manage Diabetes, designed for educating dentists in practice and how they can aid in the effort of controlling chronic disease. And the diet advice, as Steve mentioned, was to increase fiber, limit saturated fats, and limiting salt would help control blood glucose, blood pressure, and cholesterol. But there was no mention of restricting sugar intake. And this was from the CDC, NIH, National Diabetes Education Program. So I was a little bit flustered. I wasn't quite sure where that was coming from. And then the second keynote speaker, Dr. Stephen Aldana, handed this booklet out at the end of his talk, The Stop and Go Fast Food Nutrition Guide. And in the first few pages, there was a ranking of drinks. And Lipton Brisk sweet tea got a green light, which was 44 grams of sugar, recommended as a healthy drink. And I actually jumped up and chased him down and said, wait a minute, how can you possibly recommend sweet tea as a healthy drink? And his answer, there is no evidence that links sugar to chronic disease. So it's not quite what I expected to get out of that conference, but I walked away wondering what's going on. So on my own time, I just started to look up who is the sugar industry. I really don't know anything about them. And I came upon sugar.org. This is the Sugar Association's website. They represent cane and beet sugar producers in the US.
And at the time, they had a page on their website saying that sugar had been the subject of scientific scrutiny. More than 1,000 papers had dispelled the links between sugar and chronic disease. And they listed all of these major reviews, one by the FDA, two by the National Academy of Sciences, which had exonerated sugar from having a role in chronic disease. Again, I was a little bit baffled and didn't really understand how that could be. So on my own time, again, I started wondering more about these trade groups. Where did they come from? What had they been doing? And I lucked into finding a source of documents. Actually, my first one was at Colorado State University. I had board reports, financial statements, list of research projects funded by the Sugar Association. And when I saw this quote, I knew I was onto something good. The fact that no confirmed scientific evidence links sugar to the death-dealing diseases is the lifeblood of the Sugar Association. This led to, I teamed up with Gary Taubes, who Ben mentioned in the beginning. His article, Is Sugar Toxic?, got lots of attention in the New York Times. And working with Gary, we were able to get the first story out on how the sugar industry actually influenced the 1976 FDA review on the safety of sugars, and that came out in 2012. That article led to a chance to come out to UCSF and connect with some of the great folks out here and allowed an opportunity for me to come out as a postdoctoral fellow. I'm in my second year now. I've got a wonderful team of interdisciplinary mentors and funders, including Stan Glantz from the Centers for Tobacco Research, Control, and Education, as well as Claire Brindis and Laura Schmidt at the Philip Lee Institute for Health Policy Studies, and the School of Dentistry as well, with John and Deborah Greenspan and Pam Denbesten's group. And of course, there's so many wonderful people here that have generously spent their time with me, including Ernie. Are you here, Ernie Newbrun? Who had firsthand knowledge of the events that I studied in my first paper and generously came in to sit down and share some of his work with me. So, launching into the rest of the presentation, I want to start with a quote from Dr. Margaret Chan, who's the Director General of the World Health Organization, and provide a quote from her opening to the 8th Global Conference on Health Promotion in 2013, where she said, "Efforts to prevent non-communicable diseases go against the business interests of powerful economic operators. In my view, this is one of the biggest challenges facing health promotion. It is not just big tobacco anymore. Public health must also contend with big food, big soda, and big alcohol. All of these industries fear regulation and protect themselves by using the same tactics. I'm deeply concerned by efforts by industry to shape the public health policies and strategies that affect their products. When industry is involved in policymaking, rest assured that the most effective control measures will be downplayed or left out entirely." So who is the sugar industry? On a global scale, the sugar industry is the World Sugar Research Organization based in London. Again, they represent cane and beet sugar producers. This is from their website, where they advertise that they're researching the effects of sugar on nutrition, health, and well-being worldwide. This is their membership. They have over 30 members, including the U.S. Sugar Association and Coca-Cola in the U.S., so they have quite a broad reach. They publish position statements on everything from sugar and addiction to fat accumulation in the liver. The industry tactics that I'm going to focus on today have to do with industry manipulation of research. So I'm going to talk about forming research organizations, funding research to support the industry position, cultivating relationships with policymakers, and disseminating interest group data to those policymakers, all for the purpose of preventing or delaying regulation of a product. this slide compares tobacco industry research organizations with sugar industry research organizations. So above the timeline, you see the Tobacco Industry Research Committee, which was formed in 1954. It evolved into several different organizations, but was largely responsible for manufacturing doubt about the health effects of smoking. The line above represents the legacy tobacco documents library and the millions of pages that have come out related to litigation that have allowed researchers to truly understand industry tactics. Below the timeline represents the sugar industry research organizations, starting with the Sugar Research Foundation, which was actually formed as far back as 1943. And they evolved into several different organizations and are related today to the World Sugar Research Organization and the Sugar Association. And it's interesting to note that the Sugar Research Foundation was formed 9 years before the Tobacco Industry Research Committee. And in fact, some of the players in the Sugar Research Foundation went on to work for the big tobacco organizations. On the bottom line represents where I've been able to locate documents relative to the sugar industry. There's a big source of the University of Florida from the 40s, University of Illinois from the 50s and 60s, Great Western Sugar at Colorado State in the 70s, and even more recently, up until 2012, I was able to pull some documents down from the World Sugar Research Organization website that probably should have been password protected and were available for a short amount of time. So what I did for my first project was a historical documents analysis. So for the Mother Jones article, we had talked more about diabetes and heart disease. But as I was doing that work, I kept seeing all these references to dental caries, but I didn't really spend time on it. So this time, I went back to say, what was the sugar industry really looking at having to do with dental caries between this time period of 1959 to 1971? And Roger Adams was a member of the Sugar Research Foundation's Scientific Advisory Board. So he received all the communication from the Sugar Research Foundation and kept it and donated it to the library as part of his papers after he retired. This was an important time for dental caries research. It was during the early planning for the National Caries Program. President Johnson announced a new initiative to reappraise the research programs at NIH in 1966. Sugar was, sucrose in particular, I should say, was thought to be the arch criminal of dental caries at that time, the phrase coined by our own Ernie Newbern, I believe. Based on the work of Fitzgerald and Kies at NIDR, it was called NIDR at the time, looking at strep mutans production of dextrans after being exposed to sucrose and the formation of sticky tenacious plaque. So this research finding led sucrose to be put at the top of the list of the most cariogenic sugars. So the industry was under particular scrutiny at the time. We just recently published the results of this analysis together with Stan Glantz and Laura Schmidt in PLOS Medicine this past March. So the sugar industry pretty clearly stated their position on dental caries in 1950 in an annual report when they said, "The ultimate aim of the foundation in dental research has been to discover effective means of controlling tooth decay by methods other than restricting carbohydrate intake." So they were pretty clear all the way back in 1950. So they've got the research funding organization. So what did they do to fund research, looking at our second tactic? So we found that they funded research projects to divert attention away from limiting sugar intake. So beginning in 1967, the Sugar Research Foundation collaborated with the chocolate and confectionery industries, as a matter of fact. They contributed $85,000, the equivalent of today's dollars, which was only 4% of the overall budget of this project. And they studied dextranase enzymes with the intent to develop dextranases that could be added to foods, could be added to sugar, could be added to toothpaste or mouthwash, with the idea that you could continue to eat sugar and be able to break up the plaque having these dextranase enzymes added to foods. They also funded research on a dental caries vaccine. The third tactic, cultivating relationships with policymakers. As the NIDR's planning got underway in 1968 for the National Caries Program, the sugar industry reached out to leaders of NIDR. The Sugar Research Foundation became the International Sugar Research Foundation in 1968. They elected Philip Ross, and he'd worked for NIH between 1962 and 1967, and in fact, he'd been the chief of NIDR's research grants section between 63 and 65. The sugar industry also began holding a series of symposiums to evaluate the status of research on sugar and chronic disease. And they invited NIDR's intramural scientific director at the time, Richard Grulich, to present on the future of caries control. So the sugar industry got a firsthand look at some of the discussions that were going on at NIDR at the time. Interestingly, Grulich actually gave assurances to the sugar industry then that they weren't looking at limiting sugar intake as a practical, effective control measure for improving dental caries. They continued to cultivate relationships with NIDR leaders and experts throughout 1969. NIDR formed a Caries Task Force Steering Committee to begin planning the research priorities for the National Caries Program. Names are listed in the first column with their affiliation. At the same time, the sugar industry formed their own expert panel to give them advice on their own research program. And when we compared the two, we found that all but one of the NIDR Task Force Committee also sat on the sugar industry's panel. So the sugar industry got direct access to the NIDR's expert panel planning the research priorities of the National Caries Program. In 1970, funding was approved for the National Caries Program. Research priorities hadn't yet been published, but the New York Times ran an article with the headline, Halt in Tooth Decay in the 70s Foreseen. NIDR was working toward the goal of virtually eliminating tooth decay in the United States within a decade. The sugar industry clipped that New York Times article and sent it out to all of their members together with a celebratory memo describing their participation in the planning for the NIDR program. And they said, the correlation between sugar and dental decay, a practical concern of the sugar industry for many years, may become purely an academic issue within the foreseeable future. They mentioned that Dr. Philip Ross, their president, met with the Dental Caries Task Force and had worked closely with its chairman, Henry Sherp. Dental Caries Research 1969, which was a report prepared several months ago by the staff of ISRF, was submitted to the task force for its consideration. Which brings us to the fourth tactic of disseminating interest group data directly to policymakers. So the sugar industry's report on dental caries research was submitted to NIDR. We located NIDR's first request for contracts relating to the National Caries Program that was published in 1971. We found that 78% of the sugar industry document was directly incorporated into the NIDR's planning document for research priorities for the Caries Program. And not only that, but 40% of the research priorities discussed in the NIDR document were either taken verbatim or closely paraphrased from the sugar industry document. As an example, from the sugar document, it said, but since it is not practicable to replace sucrose in our diet, can anything be added to mitigate its cariogenicity? Phosphates are a possible answer. If it is not practicable to replace sucrose in our diet, can anything be added to mitigate its cariogenicity? Phosphates are a possible answer. Looking at the two documents and comparing the research priorities identified and promoted by the sugar industry to those of the NIDR task force, and then what ended up in the final request for contracts, there are a lot of similarities, particularly on non-dietary interventions. So both sides agreed to fund research for dextranase, antimicrobials, antibiotics, caries vaccine, water fluoridation, topical fluoride, and sealants. On the dietary intervention side, both sides agreed to fund research related to dietary phosphates. Where there was disagreement was research supporting the cariogenic carcinogenic potential of foods, developing a measure to be able to categorize foods as being either safe or harmful to teeth. And this was something that the caries task force at NIDR was interested in supporting and developing, but for obvious reasons, the sugar industry was not interested in developing such a test. And this research priority was left out of the 1971 request for contracts. So it was something that NIDR did not give research priority to as part of the National Caries Program. The NIDR task force, though, did hold a workshop dedicated to looking at human foodstuffs and caries in 1970. This was before that first request for contracts came out. All of the members agreed that it was desirable to have a relatively speedy and economical method of evaluating cariogenicity, especially of snack-type foods, so that parents can be warned against the more destructive products. A quick screening method is needed to provide presumptive evidence of the potential cariogenicity of accepted foods and new products that appear almost daily on the shelves of food markets. But at that workshop, there were over 10 presenters discussing many different methods to be able to measure the cariogenicity of foods. Do you do it in animal models, human models, in vitro, in vivo? Do you look at bacterial acid production? Do you look at enamel dissolution? There's so many different ways to measure the cariogenic potential of foods that it was needed to have a discussion to standardize, to come up with a way to create one method to quantitatively be able to categorize foods as either safe or harmful to teeth. So what are the implications for oral health, particularly of the 1971 research priorities released by NIDR? Looking at the results within a decade, certainly there were successes. Sealants were advanced quite a bit than topical fluoride, looking at school fluoridation programs, expanding water fluoridation. But there were some key failures. So some of the initial priorities promoted, such as the dextrinases, the phosphates, the caries vaccine at the time, that research failed to be developed into practical applications. In a 1980 prevalence survey, 64% of children were found to have dental caries, falling far short of the goal of eradicating tooth decay within a decade. And because NIDR did not take up funding of cariogenicity research in any major way, that research was then taken up by the American Dental Association Health Foundation and had significant industry participation. So preventing regulation, just around the corner from the National Caries Program, the FDA actually began to consider the idea of a dental warning label for foods. The FDA's Sanford Miller actually addressed the ADA Health Foundation examining the cariogenicity work. And he told them, one does not always require a perfect system, simply one that can separate foods into broad categories reflecting potential hazard. This research must become a high-priority effort, funded adequately, and performed well. If this support, data, and techniques are not forthcoming, the decisions will be made without the appropriate scientific input, the principal effort occurring in response to considerations other than scientific. Other initiatives that were being considered in the 1970s had to do with limiting exposure of advertising of sugary products to children. The FTC had an initiative called KidVid, which was looking at the time slot of Saturday morning cartoons and looking at identifying highly sugared products and either limiting or banning advertising. Another initiative was part of Healthy People 1990, which was planned in 1980. Looking at removing highly sugared products from school vending machines. All three of these initiatives, the FDA warning label, FTC, and Healthy People, were dependent on developing a measure of the cariogenic potential of foods to be able to put foods into safe and harmful categories. Now, of course, there was a lot of opposition to all of these proposals, as you can imagine, from many different industries, including the advertising industry. And it failed, all three of them, for many reasons. But one key factor was the fact that a cariogenicity test was never agreed upon to support these regulations. In 1991, Basil Bibby, who had served on the NIDR's caries task force and had led the workshop looking at human foodstuffs and caries, reflected back on the work of the past couple decades, looking at the ADA committee that had been examining cariogenicity, and he said the original objective to develop ways that could be relied upon to show which foods were more or less cariogenic was not achieved. The reasons for this are, first and foremost, that the problem is more complex than anticipated, and secondarily, the hoped-for supply of research funding from the federal government or industry was not forthcoming. So the next major labeling initiative came in 1990 through the Nutrition Labeling and Education Act, and this is what gave us the Nutrition Facts Panel. And what's interesting to note is that the nutrients in yellow, total fat, cholesterol, and sodium, are all nutrients to limit. And all those nutrients have a designated quantitative daily limit associated with those nutrients. But when you see sugars in white, there is no daily limit for sugars. And this is how our Nutrition Facts Panel was introduced. The other thing that was important about this act is it loosened up some of the previous regulations on health claims that could go on to food products. So that gave us the fat-free, low-calorie era. So this slide shows the original snack pack of chocolate pudding, 16 grams of sugar, now can be advertised as fat-free, only 80 calories, but the sugar really didn't change. It went from 16 grams to 15 grams. So we went from trying to categorize foods as either safe or harmful to actually promoting highly sugared foods by allowing these claims of fat-free and low-calorie foods. And we're promoting them to kids. Here's Disney's Finding Nemo on Kellogg's chewy, I'm not even sure what those are, little nuggets of starch and sugar. And they can be promoted as being healthy. Look at all the claims that are on this. Now gluten-free, 100% daily vitamin C, only 70 calories, fat-free, made with real fruit because it contains a tiny bit of apple juice concentrate. Capitalizing on the organic craze are these yummy Earth Pops made with organic fruit juice, USDA certified organic, gluten-free, fat-free, nut-free, and 100% vegan. So we're marketing highly sugared products as healthy foods. Interestingly, in 1996, the FDA approved a dental health claim for products. So the sugar alcohols, artificial sweeteners, are allowed to use a claim of does not promote tooth decay in this example. And they actually base this claim on a cariogenicity test. So the FDA allows us to talk about safe foods, but we haven't applied that same test to talk about foods that are not safe for teeth. And as Carol mentioned earlier, there are several proposals going on right now related to food policy and sugar, particularly the FDA's review of the Nutrition Facts Panel. You might notice some of the changes, having the calories much bigger type, calling attention to the number of servings per container. They're moving the percent daily value to be the first column. But the biggest change related to sugars is actually adding a line for added sugars so that people can understand how much is actually added to their products. This isn't a done deal. The public comment period is over, and the FDA is now considering whether they'll go forward with this change. The FDA, however, did not make a recommendation for a daily limit on added sugars, but this is where the 2015 Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee comes in, who actually has made a recommendation to include the less than 10% of daily added sugars as a daily limit that could be used as a daily reference value to go on these packaged products, which could actually have an impact in limiting some of those health claims that are now being used to promote sugary products. This 2015 dietary guidelines recommendation on added sugars is based largely on the very recent guideline put out by the World Health Organization on sugars intake for adults and children. And the evidence reviewed for this report was largely based on obesity and dental caries. And we're so lucky to have Paula Moynihan here, who's going to give us a firsthand account of that process. Of course, the sugar industry is a little bit worried about this. This is a 20-ounce bottle of Coke, which comes with 65 grams of sugar. For a 2,000-calorie diet, a 10% limit is 50 grams of sugar, which is only 3/4 of a 20-ounce Coke. So this could have a significant impact on the sugar industry. The last time the WHO made a recommendation on a daily limit was back in 2002-2003. The sugar industry mounted a fierce opposition to that report, and the quantitative limit on added sugars was left out of the 2003 global strategy on diet and health put out by the WHO and the FAO. And on the American side, the U.S., the sugar industry fought to keep that WHO recommendation from being incorporated into the 2005 dietary guidelines. And they used some pretty severe tactics, as this article reported. The threat was being described by WHO insiders as tantamount to blackmail and worse than any pressure exerted by the tobacco lobby. The sugar industry threatened to get Congress on its side and pull funding from the WHO, and they said they would exercise every avenue available to expose the dubious nature of the report. And while that report still exists, it still does have the 10% limit, it was never incorporated into final policy in either the WHO or here in the U.S. So this 2015 dietary guidelines proposal is actually quite important and could be quite an historic event for the U.S. related to sugar consumption. And I'm very pleased to hear that the American Dental Association has testified and commented related to this. So in conclusion, sugar industry tactics to impact the NIDR 1971 research priorities echo tobacco industry tactics. The NIDR National Caries Program was a missed opportunity to support regulation to reduce dental caries. And dental voices are needed to counter sugar industry opposition to current policy proposals. Thank you very much.
So we heard earlier from Dr. Carol Summerhays, representing the American Dental Association. And we are very proud here in California to have a Californian getting ready to take the reins as the leader of that organization when her term as president begins at the end of this year. We're also very proud here in Northern California that for the second straight year we'll have a Bay Area president of the California Dental Association. So it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Walt Weber, who's the leader of that group, and he's going to share a few thoughts from the CDA.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much for inviting me. I want to thank Dr. Featherstone and Dr. Chaffee for this kind of invitation. I'm going to talk a little bit about California Dental Association and kind of what we're doing here in the state. California Dental Association has been engaged in policies and programs to reduce barriers to dental care and improve the oral health of Californians for many years now, and we're very proud of the work we do. Many of you may be aware of our efforts, including that the most obvious thing, the most visible, I think, event that we do is CDA Cares, which provides essential basic dental services to Californians experiencing active dental pain and infection. Over the last 3 years, we have provided this charity event has provided $11 million worth of work to 13,000 patients. And of course, that's all great for the people that are there, but we really look at this as a platform. We use this event as a platform to educate the public, legislators. We were at our last event in Sacramento. We had many legislators there, policymakers, people that are making decisions on that. And so we educate the public and the legislators to understand the importance of oral health care, showing what happens if people waiting in line overnight are having toothaches and having to have teeth extracted. And if we understand the importance of prevention, all of us in this room understand that. And we're trying to get people to understand that the state dropped a lot of preventive programs over the years, and we're trying to showcase that if you can prevent problems early, we can maybe eliminate a lot of the problems people are having. In 2011, the CDA completed a multi-year extensive research project on strategies to reduce barriers to dental care. And the body of work produced a proposal of over 20 recommendations in a three-phase approach over 7 years, and serves as our framework for our continued activity and advocacy to improve access to dental services for California's most vulnerable and underserved populations. We are particularly excited, as the top priority of that work was to bring in a dental director to the state to provide leadership and direction to dental public health efforts. We understand that appointment is imminent, we think in June, and we look forward to working closely with the director and the Department of Public Health to rebuild California's dental public health infrastructure, bringing back those prevention programs that were lost. Additionally, CDA has worked tirelessly on community water fluoridation, most recently supporting the defeat of a ballot measure this past November to terminate community water fluoridation in Healdsburg, which was actually the first California community to fluoridate, and continuing efforts to fluoridate the last remaining large city, San Jose, with community water fluoridation. So these are just some of the things we do, and I'd like to take some of the time here to highlight an opportunity to prevent dental disease. This is an approach that is recognized as beneficial, and efforts have begun, but it is really worth more of our focus, especially as it relates to developing healthy eating, drinking, and snacking behaviors for children. You know, for many years, there's been a one-year age one recommendation for many years for a child's first dental visit. But unfortunately, that hasn't really been as effective in accomplishing the goal of getting children to dentists early enough to prevent disease in the populations most at risk. We see that despite the recommendation, many parents still don't take their children to the dentist before the disease process gets a foothold. Far too many visits are after the caries process has started. And adding to that, we know that many dentists still feel uncomfortable treating children under three. But most infants do see a pediatrician, family practice provider, and this is where the opportunity lies. The California Dental Association Foundation recognized the benefit of very early dental disease prevention over a decade ago when we collaborated on a multi-year project to train dental and medical providers in early risk assessment, anticipatory guidance, and fluoride varnish applications for children ages 0 to 5. Called First Smiles, the foundation was responsible for training dentists and the Center for Oral Health trained medical providers. And I would characterize First Smiles as an early effort at medical dental integration. Of course, UCSF is at the forefront of doing that. And we're hearing more about this term every day as the benefits of coordinated integrated care are part of the national conversation. And in the years since First Smiles program, some things have changed. California and many other states encourage early dental disease prevention by reimbursing medical providers for applying fluoride varnish. University dental and medical programs are providing more opportunities for interprofessional education and collaboration during the education process. And the patient-centered dental health home is being widely promoted in safety net clinics where medical and dental providers are often co-located and can provide a full range of coordinated patient care. Well, these are all good signs heading us in the right direction, but as I stated earlier, we don't yet see this translating into measurable change, especially for the high-risk populations. We know there is more work to be done. Here are some things that need to occur to make the promise of dental disease prevention more of a reality. A stronger, renewed focus on the education of medical providers, especially pediatricians and OBGYNs, that preventing the onset of dental disease begins at birth. Broader expectations for pediatricians to incorporate oral health education and anticipatory guidance into infant well child visits. Central to this is guidance on healthy eating, drinking, and snacking behaviors. This guidance must start before teeth erupt, which means the pediatrician must be engaged in these prevention activities. Even a few basic questions starts the important conversation about what parents can do to prevent dental disease onset. Children identified at high risk should be referred immediately to a dentist, and those at low risk are more able to be managed and their disease prevented at earlier ages through their visits with the pediatrician. This requires continued evaluation by the pediatrician at each visit, with a change in risk requiring a readjustment in disease prevention and activities and engagement of a dentist. This cannot happen unless both professions work closely together, which means strong communication and supported successful referral processes. We look forward to a time when children whose circumstances place them at high risk at birth become low risk because of the combined efforts of dentists and our partners in chronic disease prevention, pediatricians, and family health providers. Before I close, I want to share a little bit of information about, specifically about CD's activity to reduce soda and sugary beverage consumption. Several years ago, as the first attempts to reduce consumption via taxes or fees surfaced in the California legislature, CDA pursued research to establish the nexus between soda consumption and caries that would allow a fee on soda rather than a tax. And though legislative efforts, attempts to levy a tax or tax persists and have so far failed, CDA continues to offer support on the science and educates legislators and legislative staff on the oral consequences of sugary beverage consumption. So our policy is that we support fees or taxes on sugar-containing beverages. And in fact, we supported the San Francisco initiative and actually financially supported as well. And of course, that was one where some of the money that came out of that would be directed towards oral health care as well, which is even a better win because you're hopefully reducing demand at the front end, and at the end we're getting money to go back to start prevention programs. So that I think that the organization feels that's a great approach if you can actually get money to go to something that's going to help the oral health care. So we're proud of what we do, and our members are proud to do the best we can for our patients and communities. And I want to thank you again for letting me speak here today, and thanks again for this great conference. Thank you.
So my name is Shel Amat, and I'm a seventh year student here at UCSF, finally graduating now as an orthodontist studying global health as well, and an aspiring faculty member. And I have the pleasure of introducing our next speaker. All you need is love, but a little chocolate now and then doesn't hurt, right? Dr. Stuart Gansky over the break just quipped to me, "Man, this is a really sweet conference, isn't it?" So I asked our next presenter her opinion on how much sugar she thinks is okay in our diets. And she said, "Great question. And that's exactly what I hope to share with you in my presentation this afternoon." I'm very excited to have the privilege of introducing our next presenter and learning from her experiences. Among many other distinguished titles, Dr. Paula Moynihan is a professor of nutrition and oral health and director of the Center of Oral Health and Research at Newcastle University in the UK. She also is the director of the WHO Collaborating Center for Nutrition and Oral Health at Newcastle University, and all in such a short time. Her research interests include the interrelationship between nutrition and oral health throughout the life course and dietary intervention in older adults. Please excuse me as I read these. I want to make sure that I get it all right. Being an expert advisor on sugars and dental health to the WHO Nutrition Guideline Advisory Group, she led the recent WHO-commissioned systematic review of evidence relating to the amounts of sugars and dental caries that has informed WHO guidelines on dietary sugars. Professor Moynihan has an amazing greater than 100 publications in peer-reviewed journals, several book chapters, and is on the editorial board for several scientific journals. She has presented her research at national and international conferences alike across the globe. Our next presenter has come a long way in a short amount of time, both figuratively and literally. Literally, she has traveled over many time zones to be here right now and is scheduled to give us a riveting presentation just about the time she would otherwise be sleeping. So to combat her ostensibly fierce jet lag right now, let's give the heartiest of welcomes to Dr. Paula Moynihan.
It's an honor and indeed a great pleasure to be invited here today to speak to you about sugars and dental caries. And I'd like to thank Ben, Chaffee, John Greenspan, and also the team at the university here for inviting me and for their kind hospitality. The intake of sugars in industrialized countries remains really high, and it's also increasing in countries that are undergoing economic transition. And this has led to concern that these high intakes of sugars are contributing to obesity and other non-communicable diseases, including dental caries. And periodically, the World Health Organization issues guidelines on nutrition, including recommendations for dietary sugars. So the main aim of my presentation today is to provide an insight into the guideline development process that was adopted by the World Health Organization when they recently updated their guideline for sugar. So over the next 40 minutes or so, I'm going to be looking at the classification of dietary sugars for health purposes. I'm going to summarise the WHO guideline development process and look at the recommendations for free sugars. And then I'm going to present the most up-to-date evidence on amount of sugars and dental caries that informed this process, and then look at how the current levels of sugars intake in both children and adults compares to these guidelines. And then I'll finish off by looking at the implications of these guidelines for policy and practice and what we need to do to help bring sugars in line with these new recommendations. So in March, the WHO issued their guideline for dietary sugars, and it recommended that the intake of free sugars by both children and adults should be reduced. And this was a strong recommendation, as was a recommendation to limit the intake of free sugars to no more than 10% of energy or calorie intake. Furthermore, it was suggested that there would be benefits of further reducing sugars intake to below 5% of total energy intake to protect oral health throughout the life course. And a remark was made that for countries that have low intakes already, the intake shouldn't be increased further. So what are free sugars? Well, dietary sugars include mono and disaccharides listed here. And added sugars are all the added mono and disaccharides. And this classification sometimes includes honey and syrups, such as high fructose corn syrups, maple syrup, for example, such as it does in the NHANES data. Natural sugars include those sugars that are physically located inside the cellular structure of grains, fruits, and vegetables, and also those sugars that are naturally present in milk and milk products. Now, evidence shows that the sugars that are naturally present in fruits, vegetables, grains, and milks do not make an important contribution to the development of non-communicable diseases and dental caries. And so it's the sugars other than these that have been classified as free sugars, and this definition is that it's all mono and disaccharides that are added to food by manufacturer, cook, or consumer, plus those sugars that are naturally present in honey, syrups, fruit juices, and fruit juice concentrates. And it's the intake of these sugars that we need to be limiting for health purposes. So the WHO in 2010 published a guideline development process, and this is it's available on their website. And first of all, what happens when they issue a guideline? They follow this process for all their guidelines, but the WHO draw up a protocol with a list of questions that need to be answered in the guideline, and they put the protocol out for external consultation and take on board comments. They then convene a guideline development group, and in the case of nutrition, it's called the Nutrition Guideline Advisory Group, or NUGAG, and they have a sub-panel on diet and health. So it's this group that then looks at the questions and sets the scope and priorities and the final protocol, and in this instance, they did it for dietary sugars and dental caries, and also for dietary sugars and weight gain. The WHO then commissions systematic reviews, and these are conducted by experts external to the NUGAG committee, and myself and Sarah Kelly at Newcastle University did the one on dental caries. And once the systematic reviews are done, the World Health Organization now uses the grade process, which I'll talk more about in a moment, to first determine the quality of the body of evidence and then to set the strength of the recommendation. And this was conducted by the NUGAG group in liaison with the external experts. The recommendation is then drafted by the NUGAG and the WHO Secretariat. It's submitted to another committee, the Guideline Review Committee, who have the final say, and they issue it out for peer review and external consultation. The response is then obtained and it's considered by WHO before the final recommendation is issued. This process took 5 years. So it's a lengthy process, but I think it's useful to have an insight to it. For those of you that may not have come across GRADE, GRADE stands for Grading of Recommendations, Assessment, Development and Evaluation. And WHO use this in updating all of their dietary guidelines. A systematic review is commissioned, and from this, a general estimate of the effect of the outcome is obtained. Then the quality of the body of evidence is rated, and randomised control trials start with being high quality, and any other observational studies start being classified as low quality. But the evidence can be modified downward if there's things like inconsistency of results or publication bias. But the evidence can also be modified upwards if there's, for example, dose response, large size effect, etc. So once these factors have been considered, the overall body of evidence is rated as either high, moderate, low, or very low. Then the quality of the evidence is one factor that is taken into consideration when determining the strength of the recommendation, and it's considered alongside the balance of desirable and undesirable effects of bringing about the recommendation, the resource use required to translate the recommendation, and the values and preferences of the population. And so based on this, the strength of the recommendation is set as strong or conditional. So the strength of the recommendation is an indicator of the confidence that the desirable effects of adherence to the recommendation outweigh the undesirable effects. As I said, it can be strong or weak. The WHO tend to use the term conditional rather than weak. So strong recommendations is when it should be adopted as policy in most situations, or it definitely should be done. Conditional recommendations are issued when it probably should be done, but there's a need for more local debate and involvement of stakeholders for the recommendation to be adopted as policy. The systematic review that underpins the update of the guidelines asks these questions. First of all, what is the effect of a reduction or an increase in the amount of free sugars intake on dental caries? Secondly, what is the effect on dental caries of restricting sugars intake to less than 10% of energy intake? And finally, what is the effect on dental caries of restricting free sugars intake to below 5% of energy intake? The systematic review included all types of intervention and observational studies. The participants were apparently healthy humans of any age in any country. The exposure was intake of sugars or change in sugars, but measured in terms of amount, i.e. grams per day, kilograms per year, or percentage contribution to energy intake. And sugars included total sugars, free sugars, or any component of these classifications. The dental outcomes included dental caries measured as prevalence and or severity, DMFT, DMFS indexes. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the types of evidence, because the WHO only considers epidemiological evidence, evidence conducted in human populations, of which we have the intervention studies. Of course, the gold standard is the randomised control trial, and then we have non-randomised intervention studies, but these could be open to bias. And then with respect to observational studies, we have the cohort studies that measure change in dental caries over time and relate it to diet. And these provide the strongest data after a randomised control trial. Then we have population ecological studies. These are studies that look at data on dental caries and relate it to per capita data on sugars availability, and so they have some more limitations. And then we have cross-sectional studies of populations. These measure levels of dental caries and intake of dietary sugars at one point in time. And they're a slightly weaker study design because we know that dental caries take several years to develop, and it could be the diet several years earlier that's responsible for the current levels of decay. If you've got somebody with high caries, they may have actually reduced their sugars intake. So you need a little bit more caution when interpreting results from cross-sectional studies. And then we have what WHO classify as weaker forms of evidence, and these were excluded from the review. So it includes animal experiments, enamel slab experiments, plat pH experiments, and simple laboratory incubation experiments. Although these add to our body of evidence on the impact of diet on dental caries, alone they provide insufficient evidence unless they're supported by data from epidemiological studies. So the data sources for the systematic review included all the databases listed here, as well as contacting experts and looking at the archives in the Centre for Oral Health Research. There were no age restrictions, no country restrictions, no date restrictions, and no language restrictions, and we translated all the papers into English as necessary. We found that the data went back to the 1950s, there were no randomised control trials. The available data came from non-randomised intervention studies, cohort studies, cross-sectional studies, and population-based studies. And there was much diversity in studies and the type of data reported, a point which I'll return to in a moment. 54 studies were reported in 65 papers that examined the relationship between amount of sugars and dental caries. And the vast majority of these were conducted in children, with only 5 studies being conducted in adults and 1 study in both children and adults. So the studies of adults included 2 non-randomised intervention studies, 1 population-based study and 2 cross-sectional studies, and the studies in children included 1 non-randomised intervention study, 8 cohort, 19 population-based studies and 22 cross-sectional studies. Now, this next series of slides that I'm going to show you follow a similar format and illustrate the consistency in the findings across studies. So this slide shows the studies of adults, and here we have study type, first author, year, country, number in the study. But what I'd like to draw your attention to is this last column here, where a plus sign denotes a positive association between amount of sugars and dental caries, a 0 a neutral association, and a minus sign a negative association. So here we can see for all the studies in adults, we see positive associations. Moving on to the studies in children, and here we have the findings of the cohort studies. Again, we see largely positive, 1 study finding no association. Here we have the population-based studies, again, largely positive. More population-based studies. And finally, the cross-sectional studies. Here we see a little bit more diversity in finding, which I think is largely due to the limitations of cross-sectional studies, which I've already mentioned, and some more cross-sectional studies. So if you didn't get that quick enough, here's a summary. 42 of the 50 studies in children and all of the studies in adults reported at least 1 positive association between amount of sugars and dental caries. 6 studies reported both positive and null findings. 7 reported no association. And 2 studies reported at least 1 negative association. But the positive associations covered all ages, developing, transitional and industrialised countries, and all decades of publication from the 1950s to the current day. Now, there was much diversity in the way that the data were reported, and this caused us problems because our initial aim was to do 1 overall meta-analysis. But we found that there was a range of outcomes reported for dental outcomes, DMFT, DMFS, percentage with caries, caries incidence, caries increment, changing caries, visible caries, etc., etc. You get the picture. And the same with sugars. Some reported total sugars, sometimes it wasn't clear and we had to find out. Some measured added sugars. But more importantly, the comparisons varied. So some studies compared dental caries between high and low sugars consumers, whereas other studies compared sugar consumption between high and low caries groups. There was differences or lack of information on fluoride. There was variation in length of studies and the years over which the studies were conducted. So, as I said previously, after randomized control trials, of which there were none, the next strongest study design, according to the grade process, is the cohort study, of which 8 were identified. All of these were conducted in children. And these were a grade analysis of the quality of data was done on this body of evidence. This slide, I'm not going to go through these in detail, but it shows the 8 studies. The ones in blue are in the primary dentition, ones in black permanent dentition, so there was 4 of each. And all but one study found a relationship, and there was evidence of dose response and also a large size effect. The study of McCurran that didn't find a relationship, the groups weren't entirely comparable because they were looking at low added sugars compared to high added sugars group, but the low added sugars group had a longer period of breastfeeding, and so that might have influenced the results. But nonetheless, of the 8 cohort studies, 7 showed a positive association between amount of sugars and dental caries development. 1 showed no association. And when the grade profile criteria was considered, this evidence was rated as being of moderate quality. So this answered the does decreasing sugar impact on dental caries. But we went on to look at the studies that provided data that enabled us to look at levels of dental caries when the intake of free sugars was above with when it was below 10% of energy intake. And here we were able to do some crude meta-analysis by pooling data across study types that reported the dental outcome in a similar way. So this is a crude forest plot for data on dental caries that were reported as continuous variable, DMFT, for when there was information also on caries in those that were consuming above and below 10% of energy from free sugars. So data points on this side of the graph here favour low sugar, i.e. show lower caries when sugars intake was below 10%, compared with this side of the graph, which favours high sugar, showing lower caries when sugars was above 10%. These are the individual studies, and this is the overall data point which favours the low sugars intake. This is another crude forest plot of the pooled data for studies that had data on above and below 10% of sugars, but reported it as percentage with caries. And again, we can see that the pooled data favour a lower sugars intake. And then finally, the one study that reported the dental outcome as an odds ratio, again, favouring low sugars. But the grade profile analysis was conducted on the cohort studies. So 5 of the 8 cohort studies had data that enabled us to compare levels of dental caries when sugars intake was above and below 10% of energy. And all of these studies were conducted in children. And this slide shows these 5 studies, again, with the permanent dentition in black and the primary in blue. So Rottenen found that the low sugars group, who were consuming less than 10% of energy, had 0.5 DMFT compared with 1.4 in a group of children that had had sugars intake above 10% of energy from birth. Sticks and Blix found in a low dental caries group the sugar intake was below 10% compared with above 10% in a high caries group. Rug-Gun found that the highest free sugars consumers developed 0.9 more decayed surfaces per year than the lowest free sugars consumer and found a dose response between the intake of sugars and dental caries. Rodriguez in Brazil found that children were more than almost 3 times more likely to have high levels of dental caries when the intake of free sugars was 16% of energy compared with when it was below 10%. And Karjalainen in Finland showed that the sugars intake in those that developed caries was above 10%, whereas it was below 10% in those that remained cavities free. And the grade profile analysis that was done on these studies rated these data as of moderate quality. But we still see dental caries at 10% of energy intake, and that's what this slide shows. It's the same five studies, but this slide highlights the level of dental caries in the group consuming less than 10% of energy as free sugars. So Rodriguez et al., the children develop one cavity. Carrier line and no cavities developed. Rultanen had 0.5 DMFT. In the study of Rugg-Gunn, the children developed 3.2 carrier surfaces in 2 years, and in Stix and Blix, children developed between 0 and 2 cavities in 1 year. These are low levels of dental caries, but dental caries is a cumulative and progressive disease. And furthermore, these data were measured at the cavities level, which is a late stage of disease. So if, I mean, I'm sure you're all more familiar with indices for measuring dental caries than I am, but I am familiar with the Arcega score system, where caries is ranked 1 to 6 from the very, very earliest subsurface demineralization up to full cavitation. Now, most of the studies and the epidemiological data have used the WHO criteria, which probably includes stages 4 to 6 when cavitation has occurred. So to say caries free in these studies, what they actually mean is cavities free and not totally free of dental caries activity. So we still see dental caries when free sugars intake is below 10% of energy intake. And also, looking at data from trajectories of dental caries, we see that it increases with age. So, for example, being free of dental caries at age 12 doesn't mean being free of dental caries for life. There are data from the Dunedin longitudinal study that show children aged 12 that have less than 3 DMFS go on to develop 15 DMFS by the age of 32. There's data from the USA that shows a year-on-year increase in caries increment in adults even when there's exposure to fluoride. And a recent analysis by Burnaby and Shyam have looked at the age, period and cohort effects on dental caries in 4 countries, including the USA and England and Wales, and have found that dental caries increases of age independent of period and cohort effect, and that most dental caries is now occurring in adults. So what this means is that even small reductions in dental caries in childhood are of significance because of the progressive nature of the disease. Now, back at the end of the 1990s, the World Health Organization had a goal for the year 2000 that the average DMFT of 12-year-olds would be below 3. This goal is now outdated. Really outdated, that is no longer considered low. And the Alliance for a Cavities-Free Future have interestingly set a goal that every child born after the year 2026 will be free of cavities for life. So bearing this in mind, we went on to answer the question, what is the effect on dental caries of restricting sugars intake to below 5% of energy intake? Now, there were very few epidemiological data of populations consuming low levels of sugars intake. And the best available data came from population-based ecological studies of which the dental data was based on dental surveys of Japanese school children that were conducted before, during and after the Second World War. This was a period during which the intake or the availability of sucrose decreased from a pre-war value of 15 kilograms per person per year down to as low as 0.2 kilograms per person per year. So these data enabled us to look at levels of dental caries when the intake of free sugars was below 5% compared with when it was above 5% but below 10% of energy intake. And all of these studies showed lower dental caries levels when sugars availability was below 5% compared with when it was between 5 and 10% of energy intake. And furthermore, they all showed strong log linear relationships between sugars availability and dental caries over these low levels of sugars intake. Now, a great analysis of these studies, or this body of evidence, was conducted, and due to the limitations of ecological studies, it was rated as being of very low quality. But I think that we need to interpret this alongside the fact that we still see dental caries at 10% sugars intake, and we need to protect oral health throughout the life course into old age. It's not just about preventing dental caries in children. We're now seeing higher levels in adults. So the outcomes of this systematic review were published in the Journal of Dental Research in January 14, should you want to read up any more about it. But what I want to do is move on and look at how current intakes of sugar compare with these recommendations. And I'm going to look at data from both the USA and the UK. So these are data on the added sugar intake that were taken from the Enhanced survey of children and adolescents in the USA between 2005-2008, and this is work published by Irvin et al. In 2012, so it provides it for boys and girls. So we can see that even in the really youngest age groups, about 13% of energy is added sugars, increasing to about 17% by adolescents for the boys. And in this report, Irvin also reported that the non-Hispanic white children and adolescents had a higher intake than Mexican-American children, that there was no difference according to income, which was interesting, that more added sugars came from foods rather than beverages. I'm going to return to that point in a moment. And that more calories from added sugars were consumed at home rather than away from home. This slide shows some data that we have from the UK, where we've been doing repeat dietary surveys of children aged 11 and 12 years since the 1980s. So it shows the intake of free sugars and the intake of total sugars in 18, 19, and 2000. I must apologise that we haven't quite got the 2010 data ready to share with you yet. But the intake of free sugars has remained stable at high, about 16% of energy intake, with total sugars providing 22%. But what has changed over the decades is where children get their sugars from. So what we can see here, this is the percentage contribution of different food groups to total sugars intake. And we see this is from 1980 to the thousands. And we see the intake from soft drinks has rocketed. It's actually gone down from sweets and confectionery. Biscuits and cakes has gone up. I think this is due to people buying biscuits and cakes which have a high level added to rather than baking them in the home. Breakfast cereals has gone up. This is because people buy their sugar ready sweetened now as opposed to buying it unsweetened and adding their sugar themselves. Table sugar's gone down and the contributions of puddings has gone down. But together, sweets and confectionery provide over 60% of intake. And these are the items that also tend to be consumed frequently and in between meals when they can be most damaging to teeth. So even though the American data showed that contribution from food, which would be all these sources together, was greater than drinks, I still think that you'll find that there's a large contribution from soft drinks. What about adults? They're not. We also need to be concerned about added sugars, free sugars intake by adults. And in the UK, our diet, National Diet and Nutrition Survey has shown that adults get just under 12% of energy from free sugars. The NHANES data that was recently published that I found showed that in the 20 to 50-year-olds, around just over 14% came from added sugars, and this was lower in the 50-plus age group at 11.6%. But these values won't include those free sugars that are found in unsweetened fruit juices, whereas this, our values in the UK do. Now, I'm often asked, why did the WHO consider amount of sugars only when quite often it's argued when it comes to dental decay that frequency is the important thing? Well, I'd like to argue that there's actually very little data out there on the impact of daily frequency of free sugars intake from all food sources and the development of dental caries. Of course, there's many studies out there that if you use food frequency questionnaires, looking at the frequency of sugary items such as confectionery, soft drinks, and quite often they say, how many times a day, week, month do you have these foods? But the important fact is daily frequency. And only studies that have measured both daily frequency and daily amount of sugar simultaneously can conclude which variable is most important. And those studies that have, for example, that done by Ruggun in the UK, Burt in the US, actually found stronger relationships for amount. But that said, there is a very strong correlation between the two variables. So efforts to control one should control the other. Now, I think frequency is a really useful health education tool, a chairside tool, because when you're giving advice to a patient to reduce sugars intake, it's a lot more tangible to the patient to say how many times a day or to look at how many times a day they're consuming sugary foods and get them to work towards reducing it. But at a WHO policy level, it's really important that we have a goal in terms of amount, an evidence-based goal in terms of amount, because not only is this the way that guidelines are usually set, but it also provides a benchmark against which the intakes of populations can be compared and the success of strategies to reduce sugars judged. Also, reducing frequency alone will have no impact on obesity or other non-communicable diseases that are associated with sugars consumption. So what about different types of sugar then? This is something else that I'm often asked. Well, with the exception of lactose, the kerogenicity of mono and disaccharides is fairly similar, and there won't be a great advantage of swapping one for the other. There's animal and plant pH studies that shows lactose is less kerogenic, and epidemiological studies show that milk has a neutral or negative association with dental caries development. Some animal studies show sucrose to be more kerogenic. In some of these studies, the animals were superinfected with S. mutans. The Turku sugar study, which was a non-randomized intervention study in adults, showed no difference in the development of cavities between groups that were following fructose or sucrose diets. But when you included the precarious lesions, then I think that there was a higher development of caries in the sucrose group, and that might suggest that sucrose has an important role in the initiation of caries. We've already heard sucrose is important in the synthesis of extracellular glucan, and the work by Dom Zero has shown that this is important in enhancing strep mutans and increasing the porosity of plaque, which can mean that the acid environment close to the tooth is increased. But that said, the WHO considers that all free sugars to be of risk for dental caries and also for other non-communicable diseases such as obesity. They've all got similar calorie intakes, contents, I mean. And what about fluoride? Well, fluoride has been one of the most effective strategies in reducing dental caries. I don't need to tell an audience like this that. But the relationship between sugars and caries still exists in populations exposed to fluoride. And in the WHO review, all of the cohort studies that compared the high and low sugars intake, the fluoride exposure was similar in the groups. They all accounted for fluoride. This slide that shows a study that is very old. It's very old, but it's one of my favourites, and that's not only because it was conducted in Newcastle, which is where I now work, but it also shows the additive benefit of fluoride and sugars reduction. In Newcastle, there's a river that goes through it, the River Tyne. And in South Shields, that is south of the River Tyne, the water is naturally fluoridated at one part per million. So if you were a child in 1943 living in that area, you were pretty lucky because your DMFT was almost half that of those that lived on North Tyne side, north of the Tyne, where the water was naturally low in fluoride. So already we see the benefit of the fluoride in the water on dental caries. But then along came the food rationing of the Second World War, and the intake of sugar plummeted, and those that didn't have the protection of fluoride benefited from this in that their DMFT decreased, but those that already had the benefit of fluoride their dental health improved further. And so I think it's important that we consider both sugars reduction and fluoride. If you focus on fluoride alone, you need to be a good mopper. Fluoride helps to mop up the damage that is caused by dietary sugars. It's a lot easier to switch the taps off. Now, any talk on diet and dental caries wouldn't be complete unless I considered other carbohydrates. The diet of the population is changing. It's increasingly containing an increasing array of processed, starchy foods, etc., etc. So this slide shows two groups of starchy foods, because starch, it varies in nature. It could be cooked, it could be unprocessed, it can be treated in all so many ways. But the non-processed starch, or what I call the starchy staple foods, breads, potatoes, unsweetened cereals, rice, pasta, millet, these are the starchy foods that nutritionists are saying eat more of, get lots of your calories from these. Processed starchy foods are the corn snacks, pretzels, sugary breakfast cereals, sweetened bread, biscuits, cakes, sugared popcorn. These foods are also high in fat, quite often, salt, and many of them have added sugars. It's not the intake of these foods that dietitians are saying eating more of. These foods are likely to contribute to non-communicable diseases and also to dental caries. So let's take a look at that evidence now. And I'm going to start off with the weakest form of evidence leading up to the strongest. So we know that starchy foods like crisps, pretzels, breadsticks, I can't even talk now, it must be that jet lag, crackers and cornflakes, if you hydrolyze them with salivary amylase, yes, saliva will break them down to glucose, maltose, maltotriose, and then they can be metabolized by the oral bacteria to produce lactic acid. So when it comes to these foods, oral retentiveness is really important. We see from plat pH studies that foods containing cooked starch and processed starches do produce acid. They will drop the plat pH, but an awful lot less so than sugars. And there's work that shows that starchy staple foods decrease plat pH, but not below the critical pH. Enamel slab experiments, which is getting a little bit closer to reality, these show that cooked starches cause approximately a quarter of the demineralization that you see with sugars. And then we have the animal studies that show that cooked starch can cause caries, but less than sugars. But if you mix cooked starch with sugars, you can get caries of levels similar to that seen with sugars alone. But let's look at the epidemiological evidence, because human epidemiological studies are the only study type that measure the impact of dietary starch on the development of dental caries in humans. And these show that the older studies show that when starch intake is unaltered or increases and sugars goes down, caries goes down. There's also from the some of the older research showed that when you look at the relationship between cereals and dental caries, but you control for sugars, you don't see the relationship. And the WHO in the 2003 report said there was convincing evidence that starch-rich staple foods show no relationship with caries. But our diets are changing, and these starchy snacks are on the increase. And when I looked at the data, there are very, very few epidemiological studies that have looked at intake of all sources of processed starches or unprocessed starches and related it to dental caries. But there are some good data from the Iowa fluoride study, and this study has shown a significant association between the consumption of processed starchy foods as snacks and the development of dental caries in young children. And interestingly, they didn't find an association between the consumption of the unprocessed starchy staple foods and dental caries. But there is a lack of data in this, and we do need really good cohort studies that look at this. A lot of the dietary surveys just look at total carbohydrate. That doesn't tell us what we need to know. We need to know the relationship between processed starch and dental caries, unprocessed starches, and added and free sugars. Now, if we're going to bring sugars intake in line with the WHO recommendations, We're going to need effort at a lot of levels. We're going to need to produce and import less, use less, sell less, market less, advertise less, and ultimately eat less. If we put all our efforts into this downstream health education, we really are fighting a very difficult battle. We need these upstream approaches to support the efforts further downstream. And this is what I want to talk about now. So the WHO guidelines set the precedents for and guide national policymakers when updating national policy. And that's really important. We need to see now revision of national policies. We need to consider taxing of foods high in free sugars, such as sugar sweetened beverages, and reformulation of products high in free sugars to lower sugars intake. Cristin mentioned the food labelling of free sugars, and I'll return to that in a moment. We also need better education of professionals, but not just health professionals. We also need to educate carers, teachers, and those working in the fitness industry. And we need to have messages that are consistent across professions. So dentists need to learn more about nutrition, nutritionists need to learn more about dentistry, and we all need to say the same thing. So we need a core curriculum. At the moment, my guess is that we all teach something different. And then finally, we need health education and consumer messages from early years to schools, care, the workplace. And finally, and not last but not least, dietary advice and dental practice. I sometimes hear people say, oh, you know, dietary modification in dental practice doesn't work. There's no evidence it works. But what I'd like to say is that there may be no evidence that it does work. It's because it hasn't been researched. So there's no evidence that it doesn't work. And we need more research into effective behavioural interventions in the dental practice. I just want to mention a few of these upstream approaches before I conclude my talk. In the UK, our Scientific Advisory Committee on Nutrition has issued draft guidelines for carbohydrates, and they are now, in the draft guidelines, it says that the dietary reference value for free sugars should be 5% of calories from the age 2 years upwards. And this is based on the need that at the level of the individual, no more than 10% of calories should come from free sugars. So if everybody consumes less than 10%, then the population average should be around 5%. We've already seen this report today. This is the revised US dietary guidelines, which is out for consultation. Again, this says less than 10% of calories from added sugars. But when I read through this, it seemed to me that this applied for individuals. So if this report is recommending that individuals within the USA should consume less than 10% of their calories from added sugars, it means they've adopted the 5% guideline, because the population average would need to be around 4-6% to make everybody have less than 10%. So I welcome your views on that. Looking at taxing of sugar-sweetened beverages exists in several countries, such as Norway and France. It has done for a while, parts of the USA, but its effectiveness hasn't been fully evaluated. And at the moment, what we're seeing is a lot of research into policy simulations. And there's this recent one that I want to share with you that came out of Australia, where they looked at the effect of a 20-cent tax, 20-cent per litre tax, on sugar-sweetened beverages, and they looked at it by band of consumption from low to high, and they found that the greatest effect would be on the high consumers of sugar-sweetened beverages, despite the fact that a tax is a less of a deterrent for this group. It's what we call price elasticity, the impact that price hike has on your consumption. And they estimated for the highest consumers that such a tax could lead to an 8-gram free sugars reduction a day. That's 2 level teaspoons of sugar. So that's a sizable achievement. Even if a price hike didn't deter people from, the actual price hike per se didn't deter consumption, putting a tax on the product does send out a clear message to the consumer that the product isn't healthy. Reformulation of foods and drinks to lower their sugars intake is another thing to consider. It's been considered very seriously in the UK. It benefits the consumer without requiring a change in behaviour. But it does depend on consumer acceptance. So when manufacturers reformulate products, they do it gradually over a period of years so that you don't notice the taste change. We have sugar puffs in the UK. When I was a kid, they were sugary. You tip them out of the box and they were just in one great big lump stuck together with sugar. But over the years, they've reduced the sugar considerably. They're still sugary, but they don't stick together anymore. So that really works quite well. But what we're seeing with reformulation of sugar is that the manufacturers are replacing the sugar with non-sugar sweeteners. And although this will lower sugar's intake, it doesn't actually get rid of someone's desire for a sweet taste. And it would be nice to see reformulation so we get used to having our food less sweet. And we need more data on the consumption of the reformulated products. Now, this has worked well for salt in the UK because it was a level playing field that all manufacturers signed up to. And I don't know whether or not that's actually going to work for sugars unless there's legislation to support it and back it up. Clearer labelling, well, I don't really need to show you this slide because Cristin covered it in hers, but it's so good. I really hope that this comes in with the added sugars. People get so frustrated when they look at a fruit yogurt and you don't know how much is added sugar because some of it's from fruit, some of it's from lactose, and some of it's added. This labelling will get around that. You will automatically see how much is added. And of course, if you guys do it in the USA, we'll copy you because we always do. So, our Public Health England has an action plan, and they state that reducing free sugars is now a priority, not just for obesity prevention, but prevention of dental caries. If you listen to the media, you might think sugar was a poison, it was toxic, it was the new tobacco, and that we should all be having a sugar-free diet. 5% isn't a sugar-free diet. 5% probably allows you to have one sugary treat per day. And this slide shows what 5% looks like in food terms. So it's I don't know whether you have bran flakes in the USA, but it's a medium portion of a breakfast cereal with milk and a small glass of unsweetened orange juice. It's a donut and a glass of lemonade. It's a mug of hot chocolate, a tea with one sugar and a slice of carrot cake or another cake, 15 digestive biscuits, preferably not eaten throughout the day. It's a glass of cordial drink made with 50 mils of concentrate and a cereal bar, two fun-sized chocolate bars, or a 5-ounce low-fat fruit yogurt and half a cup of granola. So my message is that it does allow for a sugary treat. It's not a sugar-free diet, but the word is treat. Sugar has become a staple in the diet. It should be a treat, and we need to reverse that trend. Well, I know that my 45 minutes are just about up, so I'd like to draw my presentation to a close by concluding that the WHO adopted a robust and objective process when revising the guideline for sugars intake. An intake of sugars below 10% of energy is associated with lower risk of dental caries and lower risk of weight gain, and the WHO have made a strong recommendation to populations to have no more than that level, but they've also made a conditional recommendation to limit it to 5% because we still see dental caries at 10%, and with respect to obesity, the less you have, the better. Intakes are currently above this, and so there's considerable action that we need in order to make these guidelines translate into a reality. But this requires an upstream as well as a downstream approach to prevention. We need policies, we need taxing, reformulation of foods, clearer labelling, better education. It's only with this concerted effort that we will successfully translate the goals into practice and safeguard dental health throughout the life course. Thank you for your attention.
Hi, my name is Rebecca Berner. I'm from El Poder del Consumidor in Mexico. We were one of the organizations who worked on the sugar-sweetened beverage tax in Mexico. And we have, until recently, a 90-gram GDA food and beverage label. And congratulate you fully on everything that was done with the with WHO recommendations. What would your advice be to advocates? What can we do now to make sure that they're adopted and to support you in getting the word out so that governments follow them, because a recommendation is wonderful. Yeah. It's allowed the Mexican government now to come out publicly to say that they'll be changing their GDA label, which mm-hmm. had a recommended mm-hmm. intake of up to 90 grams, and to say that they're going to be one of the first countries in the world to adopt them. We're waiting to see that happen. And what comes next? What do you recommend that we do, and how can we support one another better?
Okay. I mean, with respect to the GDA, that's usually based on the adult values for intakes. And so if you were wanting all adults to have below 10%, so that your population average was 5%, then you would want your GDA to be below 50 grams per day. So it's almost halving it. Yeah. Your second question referred to what snacks we could recommend, was it?
No. What could we do together to make sure that governments actually adopt the recommendations? How do you think that we should support one another from the academic and advocate communities?
That's an interesting question. I know that the WHO have a system called GINA, where people can put information on the policies and the things that they're doing so that we can share good practice. And they are actively going to be collecting information on things that are happening. And anyone can sign up to look at this and see what's going on. And I think it'd be really good if people did that so that we could look at what's happening in different countries so that we can copy each other. Okay.
Okay, why don't we hold our questions for the panel? Let's bring up all our speakers. We can begin our panel discussion.
And thanks very much. People have been saying nice things about me today. I appreciate that. You always know why, of course. You get to the point in your career where less is done and more praise is lauded on you. But actually, I've done nothing in the field of today's topic of caries and of sugar. And there are some people on our faculty who have done remarkable things. Howard Pollock has stood by fluoride in really very difficult times, and John Featherston has a glorious career in cariology. There's one person I do want to kind of dedicate the day to, and that's Ernie Newbram. Ernie has been one of my mentors and muses, and so you won't mind me telling a story. We've been talking about medical-dental connections today. I'll give you the supreme one. I think it was the second edition of your textbook, Ernie. His textbook is Cariology. It's actually still, it's so good that, even though he hasn't done an update in a long time, we still use it a lot. And I remember he proudly gave me a pre-publication copy of the second edition. It was green, Ernie, I remember. And I looked at the spine of the book and it said cardiology. So there you are. Ernie was well ahead of the field. Ernie did so much for the field of dental science. Of course, he ended up as president of the IDR. But his own particular work on caries spanning a field that now we would call clinical and translational science, right down to basic science, was very innovative when he did it. He started out as a dentist, a pediatric dentist, a biochemist, a clinical scientist, and the cariologist par excellence, and then actually acquired a second specialty in periodontology and was a clinical periodontologist for many years. So Ernie's a remarkable man, and I just want to pray to you. Well, after a wonderful afternoon like this, one is tempted to say that it was a feast for the senses, the intellectual senses, that the flavor that the experts brought because of their wonderful knowledge. But since we're talking about sugar, I don't think I should be using analogies such as that or metaphors such as that. Instead, I'll let you all come up with some comments and suggestions for how we might make the next 15 or so minutes the climax, if you like, of what has been a wonderful afternoon. So while you're thinking about coming up with questions, let me pose a couple, if I may. And my first one really relates to this wonderful program of putting food content on labels. And, I love the new one. That looks terrific. And when I go into stores if I've got my reading glasses on. I, you know, look, but I don't see many people doing that. So my question to you with these labels is, what's the point? Does it really achieve anything?
I'd say in the UK, as well as that nutrition label, we also have a traffic light scheme on the front of our pack. So it's red if it's high in sugars, it's amber if it's medium, and then green if it's low. And that's really great if you've forgotten your reading glasses, because you can see instantly from looking at the pack. And I think people, there has been research done in the UK that to show that people use that more than they actually look at the grams per 100 grams. That's what us geeky nutritionists do, I think. But I think a traffic light system is really useful.
So that's a thought. But is there any data showing that the labeling does anything?
They've looked at it in food stamp recipients and in select population cohorts, but there's been no good cross-sectional studies on it. Every time the food labeling changes, massive education campaigns come out, and they look at consumers and they look at professionals, and they're literacy-based multi-languages. What we need to start looking at, though, I think, and it brings it back to this audience, is that whole interprofessional education on it and teaching health professionals to enforce it in their settings as well. But it's a good market for further research, that's for sure.
Ah, good. We need that. Stan, are you going to answer the question because it works with tobacco, or do you want to ask a different question?
Can I add one more thing? I'm sorry.
Did you want to say something?
I did want to just add one more thing to
your question.
I'm sorry,
Cristin.
I think another key point related to the added sugars label is what that could do for limiting health and promotional claims on the front of packages. Mm. So the huge lettering of fat-free, I've got a box of Cocoa Pebbles in my office that has this massive blue bar across the top that says gluten-free that you can see from across the room. So we could reduce some of those labelings that certainly have an impact. Yeah. Otherwise, the food companies wouldn't use them. Yeah.
I think the best evidence that the label change would be a good thing is how hard the food companies fight it. Yeah. A colleague of mine from Australia in tobacco, but who also works in these other issues, many years ago came up with what he called the scream test. And he said you can measure the effectiveness of your program by the response it provokes, and the louder they scream, the better it is. So there are metrics of effectiveness that are different than randomized controlled trials. But my substantive comment is about evidence and interpretation of evidence, because, I mean, I really like the report you came up with and the WHO's sort of what you ended up with, but I think the way, at least, that you describe the process really denigrates animal evidence, non-randomized clinical trials, and I think that's really terrible. Mm-hmm. And I serve on a panel for the state of California that deals with air pollution, and we're confronted with these questions all the time, and I really think a much better way to do it, which you kind of did in your talk, is ask your question, does all the pieces hang together? And is the animal data consistent with the clinical trials? This, because when you're dealing with a lot of population level interventions, you either can't do a randomized trial, or it wouldn't make sense even if you did. And so, you know, the fact that, yes, if you have an in vitro test or an animal study, that's quite different from a human study, and there are many limitations. But the nice thing about those things is you have a lot of control, which you don't have in a population-based study or even in a lot of clinical trials. And so, since you're plugged into the WHO process, what we do for Cal EPA is we try to look at the body of the evidence and the consistency of the evidence, rather than saying this kind of study is better than that kind of study.
Thanks, Stan.
I need to comment on that if I can, because I wasn't saying that those types of studies, such as animal studies, don't have a place. They, in fact, of course, they do. What I was saying, and actually when the WHO looked at the evidence in 2003, they did look at evidence from all sources. And when evidence was only from, say, animal studies or clinical experimental studies, then it was graded slightly lower than it would have been had there been evidence from human epidemiological studies. This time round, and it's a WHO thing that goes across all nutrition guidelines, is that they are just looking at epidemiological data. So what I was trying to say was, because alone, when those, and what happens sometimes is people take data from a study and interpret it in isolation. Like, we've got a plaque pH study. Oh, look, white bread causes as much of a decrease in plaque pH as something, therefore white bread's just as bad for you as sugars. And it's that misinterpretation. So I agree with you that you need to look at the entire body of the evidence, but the WHO process only looked at the epidemiological evidence.
Why aren't we doing sibling studies where you give the intervention to the four-year-old, particularly with dental caries, the six-year-old, the eight-year-old, they have virtually the same DNA, they have the same parents, the same food, the same habits. So you give the fluoride to the six-year-old, the four-year-old, and the two-year-old, but by the time the two-year-old is 4 years old, you can compare their caries rate with the four-year-old at the beginning of the study, and the four-year-old with the six-year-old. I don't see those studies, and that would overcome the ethical problem, the cost problem.
It would be more difficult to do it for diet because, unfortunately, it's very difficult to get people to adhere to dietary regimes for the period of time that's necessary to see a change in caries development. But I agree with you, we can't do randomised control trials because it would be unethical to have a positive control. But I think what we need are cohort studies that have modern-day design, that measure free sugars or added sugars using a robust dietary methodology and that use up-to-date methods for scoring dental caries. And I think we do need to continue to do cohort studies because diets do change over time. And we have some good cohort data. It would be nice to see more good quality cohort data, especially data in adults.
Pat? Pamela?
A couple of years ago, I read an article in the New York Times Magazine entitled The Extraordinary Science of Addictive Junk Food. And I just pulled up the article, if I could just read a quote from it. But do you remember the Lay's commercial, Bet You Can't Eat Just One? Mm-hmm. Well, anyway, in the article it was written, the coating of salt, the fat, content that rewards the brain with instant feelings of pleasure, the sugar that exists not as an additive but in the starch of the potato itself, all of this combines to make it the perfect addictive food. The starch is readily absorbed more quickly even than a similar amount of sugar. The starch in turn causes the glucose levels in the blood to spike, which can result in craving for more. So I just feel like the food industry is, of course, we know, conspiring against us. They know our limbic brains love sugar. So is there hope? You know, you can see nutritional content and how much you should eat, but that's going to be really difficult to overcome. Please comment on that.
Thank you, Pat.
Well, I just don't buy them because I know if I open a packet, that's it.
Just say no.
Howard?
Thank you for wonderful presentations. So while each of you was presenting, I was thinking of my own personal experiences, as I'm sure others were. And Riva, you talked about the effects of treatment of oral cancer or head and neck cancer. My father died from oral cancer some 16 years after it was diagnosed and treated. And of course, dry mouth was one of the concerns he had, and also mucositis and continued problems with dysplasia that were treated with laser treatment, and woke up with pain every day. Fortunately, he had an oral rinse that could alleviate some of that and made eating more comfortable. But he was always previously addicted and probably continued that addiction to sugar hard candies to keep his mouth moist, which led me to think about medicines and, you know, cough syrups and things like that. And in the health professions, we ought to be concerned about medications that we prescribe that are over the counter, that contain sugar. And I just wanted to hear from members of the panel what is being done in different countries with regard to sugar in these kinds of over-the-counter cough syrups and things like that, if you'd like to comment.
I mean, in the UK, the sugar-free would always be prescribed as the first option. I don't know whether that's the same in the USA.
In the US, for children, it is, but I'll tell you, when it comes to other products, look at vitamin pills. And Cristin showed the chewy, gummy candy things, but look at our vitamins that you can buy for children. You can buy Flintstones, you can buy gummy bear ones. And finding one that doesn't have high fructose corn syrup or sugar is impossible. They either have one or the other. So, you know, again, it's getting back to manufacturers and the cell products. I was once on a panel that I don't remember if it was Adente or Farmer Group, and Adente was a participant, that looked at product inserts to give with, this was antidepressants and antipsychotics to deal with the dry mouth issue, because of and the appetite issue to deal with the increase in decay they were seeing in patients with mental health, with mental illness, in other patients on all these medications. That went nowhere, unfortunately. But it, you speak to a very important point.
In Berkeley, which passed the soda tax, they do have a committee looking on how to spend the money. Mm-hmm. So I feel in dentistry, you know, we have the solid research. Now we're the tag along. And when the taxes go through, children's oral health is left off. So maybe some comments on my irritation.
Thank you, Steve. Who would like to pick that one up?
Well, I think maybe if you should move to the UK because
well, we've often told him that.
I'm joking. Because Public Health England have stated that the sugars reduction is a priority for obesity and dental caries, and I was delighted to see that dental caries got in there. And I've heard several presentations now being given by people from Public Health England at stakeholder groups, and the caries word is on the agenda, so that's very pleasing to me.
And the tax, if it's taxed in the UK, will be used for dental health?
I don't know whether a tax will ever come in.
I don't think that's going to happen.
I just wanted to ask you, Steve, whether you had attended any of those meetings to get your voice heard regarding some of those initiatives. And I think that's what I would encourage, is more dental voices getting out there and getting the message out.
Dr. Benzian?
Just a quick comment on the use of tax money. Some countries have found a solution to earmark those funds to go into health promotion foundations. Thailand is a big example for that. It generates a huge revenue. Taxes from tobacco, other sin taxes can go into such funds and be used for health promotion purposes. That has worked very well, and WHO actually recommends it. My comment is slightly related to your first irritation. While you feel hijacked by the chronic diseases and the whole movement that has come around that, I see this more as an opportunity. And I'm actually thrilled to see that WHO has taken oral health, or the direct relationship between sugar intake and caries, as an example to highlight the link between sugar and the chronic diseases. We should not be fooled by WHO's interest in caries. It is not a sudden awakening that they feel that oral health is important. They use this as a vehicle to promote sugar, lower sugar intake for the sake of chronic disease prevention. And I was wondering, since you were involved in this process, Paula, what was the discussion WHO internally on this? Was there anybody speaking in favor of oral health? Was it your WHO collaborating center raising this issue as a good argument and making a case for better prevention and control of coronary diseases? Because the second part of my remark goes into what are we doing with this information and with this guideline? As a profession and as advocates for global health, where we feel that our area that we care for is so neglected and doesn't get the attention that it deserves, how can we use and leverage this guideline to increase priority for oral health?
Thank you, Habib. Who'd like to pick that one up?
Well, I mean, I wasn't party to all the early discussions with WHO when they were doing the priority setting and scoping. So I became involved in the process once it had been decided that they were going to look at sugars and caries. And I concur with what you say, that the data on dental caries enables the limits to be set, whereas it's more difficult to do that with respect to obesity because we just know that less is better because it's an energy effect. That said, the WHO do write into their priorities that we need to consider oral and systemic health and the links between oral health and systemic health. And they are very aware of the cost implications of dental diseases. I mean, it costs between 6 and 10% of healthcare budgets in industrialized countries. And in developing countries, it would exceed, you know, the treatment of dental decay would exceed the entire budget. And they are very aware of that. So I think it is on the agenda. And I'm going to keep it there.
Thank you.
I think today was a wonderful, wonderful example of how research really informs policy and how policy can have an impact on research. I thought all of your presentations really spoke to the interplay between those. And as somebody who's a dental health policy researcher here at UCSF, I often feel a bit lonely because there's lots of clinical researchers and then there's these wonderful health policy researchers, but not a lot. So I hope that this is the beginning. And when Cristin came, I was so thrilled. So I feel like there's another one. I really hope this is the beginning of more of these types of discussions because I feel like that the dental school can be really enhanced in terms of the application and the relevance of their clinical research and their basic research with these connections to the health policy. And as you've shown, the health policy is only as strong as the research that informs what they can actually create policy on. So I just really think it was just a wonderful, wonderful way to bring those two things together and on an issue really on a global scale. So that's my comment. My question is for you all, thinking about sort of this dearth of policy generally being paid attention to in many of the dental education community or dental realm outside of sort of more organized dentistry and the policy positions that they have, what other ways besides making an individual comment, you know, on a regulation, what other things do you think that we should be doing in terms of our education and in terms of our global health efforts to bring more policy competence to our professionals so that they can engage in this broader advocacy arena?
I think one of the things we need to look at doing is one of the points you made, and that's collaboration. You know, this is a unique meeting, and I really congratulate Ben and his team on pulling together nutritionists and dental health professionals and dental policy people, because I think that's a first. And to me, to be that interplay in the audience together, on the panel together, is something we need to promote more of. I think going together to these types of meetings, doing the research together, rather than thinking, oh, I can pull in the oral health stuff, I know it, or the dentist thinking, I can pull in the nutrition stuff, I know it. But bringing all the experts together will lead us to a lot of those changes. And I'll just put in one plug, and I'm sure Paula will join me, and that's the IADR has a lot of organizations, one of them being the Nutrition Research Group, which is a great venue for pulling some of these people together to put stuff out there.
In relation to Professor Moynihan was saying how difficult it is to measure frequency in human studies. And that's where I think Professor Glantz was really right on, because in caries, animal caries, we have so standardized the animal model, we can control the microflora, and Professor Koenig in the Netherlands, well, he did it already in Switzerland, developed a feeding machine. So it was worked like a lazy Susan, and you could feed a rat 4 times a day, 8 times a day, 24 times
We're
a day.
We're going to introduce you for dental students. Quite
so it really, I think we shouldn't sell animal studies short, because they can do get us information which we couldn't possibly get with humans. And finally, I have a question for you. You referred throughout your presentation about percent of energy intake. And I'm used to saying percent caloric intake. Is this the difference between America and the United Kingdom, that we are two countries separated by a common language?
That's exactly it, yeah. Energy,
thank you,
calories.
Good. Ben, I'll turn it back over to you. Thank you very much.
So just a few more words. We've invited Dr. George Taylor to step up to the mic and give a bit of a reflection on our afternoon events, what we've heard from our esteemed speakers. And it's my pleasure to turn it over to Professor Taylor, who's, in addition to his distinguished research career, was the man who hired me. So I'm always indebted to him for his good decision making. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, Ben, and thank you for accepting the offer. That was a tremendous move on our department's part, and we continue to, and the school's part for that matter, and we continue to see the benefits and appreciate the way that your career is growing, and as well as the contributions that you're making as we move forward. I think having a reflections at this time is a bit anticlimactic, given the questions that have been asked, given the comments that have been made to these excellent presentations. We've started from a clinical point of view, I would say, with Riva's presentation, giving us some perspectives on relationships, and also the fact that it's more than a two-way relationship. This is what I got. I've been thinking about bidirectional relationships, but actually, the Riva's presentation gave us some perspectives to think of this in multi dimensions. And this is pretty much one of the themes of today, as we think about the adaptation, interventions, as we think about strategies for function, and in terms of oral cancer, oral facial pain, including muscles and joints, including the oral lesions, what kinds of adaptations, the whole notion of enjoying, not only just enjoying food for nutrition, but the cultural component. I think that rang very loudly, that we want our patients to be able to not only function, not only attain adequate nutrition, but to enjoy their diet and enjoy their diet on their own terms. I think that's a very powerful concept that we would think about. It helps us in how we would think about our patient education, and also helps us in how we would think about our healthcare professional education. And that takes us to the other point, not the only other point that Riva made in it. And she drove the point home to me about not only about interprofessional collaborations, coming from, first of all, interprofessional education, and then interprofessional practice. with the focus on diet and with the focus on nutrition. I'm happy that you shared with us the model in terms of health and nutrition risk assessment, the way that we need to triage our patients. And I would also interject and stimulate me to think about triage the way that we think about our patients. This is another issue for us to become more aware of the health literacy, the nutritional health literacy, the dynamics that come and go into play with diet and the relationship with diet and nutrition. And that certainly comes to play, certainly comes to be very clear when we talk about nutrition, sugar. And that would take us to Kristen's presentation. Just to open our eyes to how the sugar industry manipulates research, and it's not just the manipulation of research that Kristen shared with us. It's also manipulation of manipulation of policy. We had Beth raise some important questions about and made some important observations about how the way that policy transcends all we've been discussing today. I took note of one comment where I think Ernie made a distinction between the scientists and policy decisions. I'd argue that perhaps we need to think about the clinical scientists, the epidemiological scientists, and as well as the political scientists. So I would argue that there perhaps is not that distinction when we talk about political science, policy, and political science, and we think about the clinical and the laboratory scientists. I appreciate that. I think we all appreciate a representation from the American Dental Association and the California Dental Association in terms of the advocacy, in terms of the support of research, and also in terms of supporting the ways in which the funds from the taxation for the sugary beverages could be used. I think those are things for us to think about. They are strategies that are important to pursue. I'd like to mention, I won't say very much about Paula's presentation because it was the most recent one, and we've had quite a bit of discussion already. The insights that we got in terms of the WHO guideline development thing is quite important. Understanding the grade criteria, grading of recommendation, assessment, development, and evaluation, a way of assessing evidence. The question about evidence came up. We had some discussion about the validity and credibility of different types of evidence in terms of moving our knowledge base forward as we look at diet, nutrition, and most particularly sugars in today's meeting. I appreciated that we had reviews and evidence from those reviews, the systematic reviews. We learned about the ability to conduct meta-analyses or the limitations of conducting meta-analyses on the evidence that we learned about today. We talked a little bit about assessing carious lesions. A practical point for us, as we are moving our curriculum forward right now, we're in the midst of developing a more systematic, more evidence-based approach to assessing caries in a way that we can continue to make decisions about management of those carious lesions as we go forward. I think the types of the types of sugars, the notion of the distinctions of the kinds of food, the starch-containing foods, the distinctions between processed food, processed starch, cooked starch, and non-processed starches, the impact of paying attention to all those different dimensions in terms of diet and in terms of their role, the role of sugar in caries is important. So, to me, one of the, not only the facts, not only the evidence that we received has been so helpful, but it's also the whole day has been a way of thinking about all of these issues. And not only thinking about them, we've also had strategies suggested on what to do. And that takes it to another level. And I think that's probably what would put the highlight on this afternoon's symposium is that we had evidence, we talked about designing studies, we talked about conducting studies, we had specific conditions to address, and then we had strategies, interventions, and once interventions clinically we talked about, and also policy interventions, the whole notion of thinking of how to think better about all of the topics that occurred. I'd like to give a great round of applause to everyone who presented today.
We have many people to thank who made this event possible. Certainly all of our speakers, many of whom came a long ways to be here. Everybody who shared their thoughts and introduced speakers, everyone who gave comments and participated in the panel, thank you. Made this a true, ongoing, and engaging conversation. We have co-sponsorship this year from the Philip R. Lee Institute for Health Policy Studies. They reached out to us. They got excited about this topic. They wanted to partner with us. And that partnership is going to be realized through the videotaping that's been going on all afternoon. And we're very excited to have that online. So if you've registered for the conference, once the way to access that video is available, expect us to send that back out to you and disseminate that widely so we can share it with people who couldn't be here today. Huge thanks to our support staff that make this possible. In fact, there are many, many people who contribute in one way or another, but none more important than the people you see listed in the program. I want to give a big round of applause to Terry Sonoda. To David Hand. And the incomparable Roger Maras. And of course, we had many volunteers among our students who were checking people in today, helping us get our CE credit, working with some of the technical issues here at the podium. So a huge thanks to all of them and everybody who makes this possible. And now, the fun part. We do have a few awards. You've seen the awardees in our program, so I don't need to reveal any surprises. But I will say a few kind words. We had some fantastic nomination letters come in, and it really tells us what outstanding people we have working here at our institution in global oral health. I'm really pleased to announce our winner for faculty achievement in global oral health is Maria Orishana. She's a faculty member in our Division of Orthodontics. And people ask, so what is global orthodontics? She's really invented something here. And you know what it means is going out and partnering with collaborators on an equal level, from formulating the question, doing the research, analyzing the results, and disseminating the findings at conferences, in papers, and doing that as equal partners. It means taking on mentees, more mentees, I think, than anybody should ever be asked to take on, and doing that willingly, happily, and making them equal partners in the process. And so for all those reasons, let's give a big round of applause to Maria Orishana.
Thank you very much for this award, and I just want to say a few acknowledgments. First to my mentor in global oral health, Dr. Greenspan, right here, an incredible mentor and a great example to follow. And this is not possible without the help of wonderful collaborators. And three of them are here today. They came all the way from Mexico to participate in the conference. We cannot do this also without students. And I have an incredible group of students, a large number of students, because I cannot say no when they are interested in global oral health, and I keep taking them on. And yes, perhaps there are way too many, but I'm still getting more students. And then last, I want to thank, you know, the support of my family, because it takes a long time away home going to collect this data. And so, you know, time that I take away from my family, but they understand my passion, and that's why they support me. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
In all of our residency programs, we ask our dental residents, they're training to be oral surgeons, orthodontists, pediatric dentists, we ask them to engage in research. It's a whole part of the ethos of our school, including in our pre-doctoral program. And many of them do it willingly. Some of them manage to do it kicking and screaming. Many of them do the minimum. Some of them do a little bit more than the minimum. And some of them spend their entire residency doing research and getting excited about it. And I don't know if this guy ever learned how to twist wires, but he certainly did fantastic research somewhere in between his time. So Shalamut, please come up and receive your award.
Thanks, everybody. One of the hardest things when you have a desire to contribute to something greater than yourself is finding people who will actually guide you along in that process and nurture you. You need mentors, and I've been so fortunate to be able to find so many great people here. And I wouldn't have been able to do anything that I've been able to do without the mentorship and guidance of all of you. And everybody coming together like this, it's just an amazing place. And there's a reason why UCSF was my dream school. It's been an honor to be here. And fortunately, technology is so great in orthodontics now, we don't really even need to bend wires.
So here at our school, we get, you know, outstanding students. You know, I had the privilege to spend 1 year on our admissions committee, and it was just daunting. I mean, the hopeful students that would like to come here are just outstanding. I mean, it's humbling to read the resumes of these students. And then the students who do come here, who get accepted, are just, you know, I'm really humbled every day to have the privilege, you know, to work with my colleagues, to work with mentees, and to work with the future leaders of our profession. And we have some outstanding leaders. We have many of them within our student body, many of them who do research. And to pick a winner is very difficult, but I'd really like to highlight one who's just been outstanding, who's come in here and been very much engaged in research, in communities, and thinking long term, how can I have the biggest impact on my community? So I'd like to award our future and current leader in the field, Mona Najat.
Want to say a word? Sure. Just to say a few words, this is such an honor, and I'm so humbled to receive this among such incredible people. I've really enjoyed meeting you all and hearing the amazing things that you're doing. But I just quickly wanted to thank some of my mentors in this process that have really like changed the way that I view my life and view my future. And first and foremost, Dr. Iman today has been like my UCSF mother, and she's really taken me under her wing and opened up the doors to so many incredible opportunities and projects. And also Dr. Sokol Gutierrez, who's inspired me in so many ways. She has this incredible capability of plugging everyone in and connecting everyone who you never think were connected. And It's very inspiring. And also, Dr. Shafi, thank you so much for your guidance. It's been incredible. Thank you.
So just two last very important final thank yous. And of course, to our dean, John Featherstone, whose leadership, his support, moral support, and of course, financial support from the dean's office makes this day possible. From the very beginning, as you heard, global health has become a priority here at our school, and I hope we can say that for many years going forward. So thank you. And of course, to Dr. John Greenspan, who started this whole event. And I guess, darn it, we're just going to have to keep doing it. So thank you for everything you do. You've been a mentor to me, as well as many, many other lucky professionals. So you've been wonderful. Thank you.